That, and I'm rocking the
sticking your fingers up your ass.
Absolutely. Well, I'm rocking the 1980s porn star, early to late 70s rock star, Cody Rhodes. Pedophile mustache!
Look at him!
I don't think it's registered.
Oh my god, dude.
Yeah, he comes out from taking a shower earlier, and yes. He says, "What do you think, man? I got the little stash." I said, "You've got to be fucking kidding me."
I told you I was
going
to do it.
You're going to do a 1980s porn stash.
Yes.
And then I guess it's going to turn into like a weekly gimmick for you where you're going to try a bunch of different things.
Yeah. I did the pin thing last week. The little thin fucking thing that goes all the way around.
Right.
I've done the goatee.
Yeah.
I've done the big beard. I've done the clean shave. And next week, and then paying homage to Mr. Hulk Hogan, I'm going to do the Fu Manchu.
Oh, Jesus.
The Fu Manchu.
So you're going to keep that on all week.
Yes.
You're going to rock that all week, then you're going to extend it next week.
Next year, I'm going to let it grow out.
Isn't this part going to be bigger than this part down
actually,
here?
Actually, I'll probably shave
you're going to have to
morning.
Trim it.
Tomorrow morning I'll shave. I'll let the whole fucking thing grow for a week. And
yeah.
It grows fast.
Right.
So then I'll just do the Fu Manchu with what I got.
Like, that's what this must have hit puberty. The guy
it
like
barely looks like it because it's very thin. It was kind of a last minute decision.
Yeah.
So it looks like a little kid trying to grow a mustache.
It looks like an 80s porn stash.
Well, that's what I'm going for.
Like.
So.
Well, you fucking nailed it. Nailed it. Get it? Nailed it. 80s porn. Nailed it.
Good joke.
Porn.
Great joke to start the show.
Rolled right off the tongue. You want a joke? I got a joke for you.
Yeah.
What do you call a fish with two knees?
Oh, Christ.
A toony fish!
Yeah.
Yo, what do you call a dog with two legs?
I have no idea.
It doesn't matter what you call it, because it's not going to come anyways. It's only got two legs.
What do you call cheese? It ain't yours.
Nacho cheese!
You're supposed to pretend like you don't know.
Oh. What is it?
Nacho cheese!
Nacho cheese!
Smack your knee because it's funny!
God!
You know, this is why I come off way louder. You got that fucker pointed right at me.
But I'm louder than you anyways.
Well, just stick it straight up in the air there. Oh, it doesn't go up.
Stick it straight up somewhere else. You know what I mean? So,
Got to be one or the other.
Yeah, it's got to be one or the other.
Right.
Well, anyways, so listen. We got a lot to talk about tonight. We had TNA Bound for Glory, okay, this past Sunday night. Listen, Bound for Glory was a really, really good show. Okay,
and you know this because you watched it.
Yeah, I had it up in the background, and then I had the
you
NFL
just told me you
game,
didn't
right?
see it.
No, I
didn't pay attention to it.
Right, I had the NFL game that, all right, basically what happened is, a lot of you guys know that I own a website based off TNA only. Nothing but TNA news, TNAWrestlingNews.com.
.com.
Owned it for years and years and years now. And basically on pay-per-view nights, similar to what we do on WWE pay-per-view nights, we do play-by-play coverage.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Tokyo, Japan is a 13-hour delay from the United States.
Mm-hmm.
Watch what?
Uh-huh. I'm going to keep doing that until you get pissed.
Okay.
So tell your story.
Well, it's old now, but yeah. Okay.
Mm-hmm. What happened?
Do I do that or something?
No. I'm just trying to annoy you.
Oh.
I figure if I do that enough while you're trying to tell a story, you'd be like, dude, would you shut the fuck up?
No.
I'm trying to get a rise out of you. Like a porn mustache, you know, you get the rise.
Ah, yeah, good one. Good one.
That
rolled right off the tongue.
Yeah.
Rolled right off the tongue. I thought mine was better. Nailed it.
It was all right.
Nailed it. But anyway, so we were doing, you know, I started doing Bound for Glory play-by-play coverage, and because it was a taped show, and they taped it, I mean, spoilers were out by, what, 9,
early
10,
in the day.
11 o'clock
early
in the
afternoon.
Right, it was the morning.
Well, I put them up at 11 a.m., I believe.
Right. So
I didn't wake up till 10, so.
because spoilers were out, it was going to be a thing where, you know, a lot of people were going to read. And not only that, but every match had, you know, it was like a Japan tag team against TNA tag team.
Mm-hmm.
Or it was a Japan star. Shut up!
It worked.
All right, so, well, yeah, it worked long ago when I told you to stop.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. But anyways, so it was, you know, I think there were only two matches that actually had, like, TNA stars. And I think it was Velvet Sky and Havoc, and it was, I can't remember who else was involved. But anyways, so it was, you know, nobody, Velvet Sky and Havoc was one of them.
Yeah.
The
Gail Kim, maybe?
Yeah, I'm not sure.
I thought she was injured.
Anyways, so I went with it and I started doing play-by-play coverage.
Oh, that's
right. Traffic was so bad. It was worse on Sunday night than the normal traffic that we do. Pretty much at any point during the day, there's 40 to 50 people always on TNAWrestlingNews.com.
Mm-hmm.
And on Sunday night, I think we had like 37 people on the website or something like that. We had the free audio up and we were doing the text play-by-play. And it was so bad that I said, you know what, I'll keep the audio up for those that had already tuned in. I'll keep the audio up and I'll keep doing the play-by-play. But I put it all into one post. It was the worst traffic. And of course, I mean, Bound for Glory, it meant nothing. I mean, TNA is
really
going to be annoying.
It was really a throwaway show. I just felt like you said that, so it was funny. It was really more of a show for Japan, like for the Wrestle One company. Like, the fucking title wasn't on the line on their WrestleMania show.
Right.
Many of their top guys weren't even involved in the show. They didn't really advertise jack shit until, like, the last week or so before the show. Like, it really was a throwaway show. And how about the, I was kind of ignoring you, so you might have already said this, but the Mike Tenay Taz commentary with the echo and all that shit, did you talk about that?
It was brutal, man.
Did you bring that up?
No, I
haven't. It sounded like, you know, if you're on the phone with a friend and you can tell they're in the bathroom because it sounds real echoey and hollow, you know.
Right.
That's what it sounded like. He brought the, what the hell? You had me tune into the audio, and I was listening, and sure enough, it was like, oh, yeah, we're doing a great show here tonight in Japan. It was fucking horrible, man.
What happened was, I mean, because they had taped the show, Taz and Tanay weren't overseas with the group.
Yeah.
They were, like you said, back in
Nashville.
So,
but they could have pre-recorded it and edited it so that the quality was good. They decided to go live.
They went live. And I thought it was going to be, you know, in the very beginning of the show, it was going to start out and they were going to be able to get that fixed. But it was like they were in
Did it stay like that?
It stayed like that the entire
room. Oh, that's not annoying at all.
And it sounded like they were in a hollow room. Just
like a bathroom.
Like a bathroom.
You ever talk to somebody in the bathroom?
Yeah.
You could tell they're in the bathroom because
right.
They got that real shitty
there's
hollow
nothing,
sound.
There's nothing in there. So, it was brutal for the entire show. But the matches were awesome, man. The matches on Bound for Glory.
What was the best match
really
on the show? I heard the triple threat with Kaz Hayashi, Samoa Joe, and Low Ki. I heard that was
there. Really wasn't a bad match. There really wasn't a bad match at Bound for Glory, and I watched at least the first half of the show, and then, like I said, man, I kind of tuned out because play by play was just it wasn't worth it. It was pointless to waste your time. It really was, and I make a lot of money off on pay-per-view nights, especially
big
for
time.
TNA because of the advertising company.
How about
so
this? When the show was over, was there a big rush of traffic?
Nothing at all on.
That's
on
why
Sunday
I figure
night.
If you're a diehard, the only people that watch TNA period on even on TV for free are diehard wrestling fans. Mm-hmm. Anybody that watches a TNA pay-per-view are fucking super diehard fans.
Mm-hmm.
Any super diehard fan would have they're on the internet every day.
Right.
They would have already read what happened.
Right.
Unless they purposely avoided it to watch it live, which they wouldn't, you know, very few would do. So, of course, anybody that is interested in the show would have already seen or read what happened.
Right.
So they're not going to tune in during the show. That's why you got shitty traffic. They're not going to rush in after the show to see what the news after the show is because they already know if there was anything big after the show, it'd already be online because the show happened 14 hours ago. You know?
And not only that, but it was like the hype going into it. There was no
hype on
Impact. And I think TNA right now, I mean, let's be honest, dude, they're more concerned with the television deal. Absolutely. I mean, the future of the company depends on that television deal. A lot of people are expecting something possibly this week, some sort of announcement to come from
every
TNA.
Week, Dixie promises the roster,
yeah,
hey,
know,
this blah, 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 we're going to announce it.
I think they're in the final stages.
Isn't January 7th?
That's the first week in
the new
year.
That's the first Wednesday of the new year where they're supposed to air. Isn't that the day that Dixie promises there will be a...
Well, Spike TV's contract with TNA expires at the
end of
2014.
Year, yeah.
So after 2014, you've got to figure, if they've got a television deal, yeah, it's going to come.
Promote it.
It's going to come.
But
on
they should
that
announce, if they've got it, which they would have to before the fucking week of the show, they would have to promote it because
Spike
you want
TV,
people to tune in.
Is Spike TV? I mean, listen.
Is Spike TV what? Going to take them?
No, Spike TV may say, you know what? You're on our network. And we're not very happy with
it. But they could promote it, like, with press releases. But I'm saying,
and either by commercial time on Spike TV as well. But on the actual live Impact broadcast, is Spike TV going to allow Mike Tenay and Taz to say, oh, by the way, we're leaving this network. We're going over to WGN America on Wednesday night.
Or Velocity, like that. Or whatever.
Right, wherever it may be. Is Spike TV going to allow Taz
and Tenay to do that? They've been pretty accommodating.
They really have, right?
I mean, they extended, because they were supposed to be up this month, right? And then they extended it to the end of the year to, you know, throw them a bone.
Right.
To wrap up business.
Not only that, remember when WWE left Spike TV for the USA Network? I specifically remember.
They weren't allowed.
They weren't supposed to do it.
Yeah.
But Jim Ross and Jerry Lawler would always sneak in little things.
That's what I was going to say. Because
they didn't care.
Is Impact live? Some weeks it is, some weeks it isn't.
It's taped. No, it's taped.
Oh, now, they've taped months in advance. Okay.
Do you know that there are no more TNA live events for the rest of 2014?
Really?
No house shows. The Impact tapings, they're already taped.
Well, they've got the overseas tour next year, so apparently they plan on being in business in some form or fashion.
They plan on continuing on.
But they're not re-signing any of their top guys, so it's really going to be like a meat and bones kind of fucking operation from here on out. Like, whatever it actually takes to run a show, that's all they're willing to commit to.
That's it.
They're not signing any big contracts. They're not paying any big money.
Right.
Although there was a rumor, which kind of started a media war between these two people, that they tried to send feelers out to the best in the world. CM Punk,
yeah. Well, you know what? We'll talk about that more in depth here in our numero dos. But listen, you've got the top free agent. We'll talk about it right now. You've got the top free agent in the game, right?
Without
CM Punk.
Yes.
Why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you at least reach out to him, whether it be direct contact or through a Colt Cabana or somebody that's close to him?
Yes.
And at least if he says no, he says no.
That's the worst he can do is say, no, I'm not interested.
If
you gotta at least try.
If you don't ask,
yes,
you don't know.
It's like if you want to bang a hot chick, you gotta at least try.
You gotta try.
Even if you're 99% sure she's gonna shoot you down, you gotta at least try. Because what if she says yes? Holy shit, I'm getting
at
it.
At least throw it out there.
Yes.
So that's
put
what
it
happened.
In the air.
You know, that's what happened where TNA kind of reset. It was the same thing with Alberto Del Rio. The second that they found out that he was gone from WWE, they immediately reached out to him. And I think we're going to see Del Rio in TNA.
If TNA exists.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but I don't think we will. I think he's got too much money to make
in
Mexico and Japan.
Yeah.
I think he can make a ton of dough in both Mexico and Japan.
But I think TNA is willing to pony up the money for a guy like Del Rio.
When you say pony up, you have to say the dough. That's the expression, pony up the dough. Not pony up the money.
Pony up the dough.
Yeah. The do-ray me, baby.
Why dough? Pizza dough.
I don't know.
I know it's pizza dough, but why?
But there's a lot of, like, some people say Skrilla, some people say loot.
Some people say that's the tits.
The cheese, the cheddar. We're talking about money.
The fuck is the tits?
It's when you say it's the tits, you're saying it's the greatest, it's the best. And what's the best part
the
of
cheese?
The female body?
The
tits.
Cheese, maybe because you slice up the cheese and it looks like mini dollars. I don't know. No. Take a knife to the cheese and slice it up.
Anyways.
All right. So here's what we're gonna do. TNA Bound for Glory. I be honest with you, I couldn't tell you.
That's our coverage of Bound for Glory.
That's about it for Bound for Glory. Gonna talk Monday Night Raw from last night. Big news coming out of Raw.
Your buddy's out of a job.
In addition to the Hell in the Cell matches, my buddy, a guy that I've known.
I remember
for
back in the day,
a long time.
When he first got in, you guys would talk all the time, and you were telling me, "Yo, this guy's gonna end up being like the main guy. Like he's gonna replace Lillian Garcia." I'm like, "Who the fuck is he? No, he's not. He's gonna be some jerk off jobber that does superstars in or what was their show back then? Oh God, the green logo. I want to say Velocity."
Velocity.
It was
a Saturday Morning Slam that had.
No, that was recent. I'm talking about Sunday Night Heat days.
It was
Velocity.
Velocity. Yeah. Right. With the green.
Yep. That has nothing to do with anything. My point was, I just thought he's going to be like the third string jerk off announcer.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Like when Tony Chimel has the flu, he'll do the announcing.
It had been a while since I had spoken with Justin Roberts, who was released from WWE following Raw last night. I think there's more to that story.
There's conflicting reports.
What is
you should
there.
Tell people what some of those are. Like the most basic one is his contract was up.
Contract
he
was
couldn't
up.
Come to terms And as WWE stated in their they decided not to renew his deal. Contract, right. I guess they had that clause where if it rolled over, they could say, no, we don't, you know, want to re-sign him.
On the other side of things,
and this is the interesting one,
there are a couple of different people. I got two emails myself today, and other sites are saying that they were contacted by fans that were in attendance as well, and said that during the Randy Orton versus Dolph Ziggler match, which was
great.
a very good match, by the way.
What a bitchin' finish. That RKO was awesome.
That was pretty sick. Yeah, yeah.
It was the tits.
It was the tits. Yeah. We're going to get into Monday Night Raw here in just a couple of minutes. We'll run it down from top to bottom. But good show last night.
This is my big thing. I went on a rant on Facebook.
It's all about Hell in a Cell last night.
And everybody was kind of disagreeing with me, I got to admit. They didn't see it the way I saw it. And that's just because I've been watching so much of that Monday Night War documentary. I've been watching a lot of the DVDs, you know, the stuff I watch all the time. Yeah. And it reminds you
how awesome
it used to be. So, yes, if you ignore all that and just look at the last several weeks or several months of shows compared to those, last night was a pretty good show.
It was pretty good, man.
But, like I put on the Facebook post, if you were to take last night's show, put it in a time machine, and drop it into the 1999 year 2000, it would be the worst piece of shit you've ever seen. So people's expectations are so fucking low these days that something like last night is considered a good show.
But, you know,
if you do compare it to the recent shit that we've been seeing, it was, I mean, the matches were good.
There was some good stuff.
The Wyatt family vignettes were interesting.
Mayday Leaks was on the show last night.
Yeah, whatever.
Chris Chrisley.
I hate Todd Chrisley, right?
Todd Chrisley.
I hate that fucking guy. Oh, God, I hate him. When I see those promos...
Well, class not ass.
Yeah, class not ass. You know, I want to see your red dragon snapping when you get out of here. I hate his voice.
I'm going to teach my sons to be good boys or something like that.
He seems like a fag, but he's supposedly a gay guy, sorry. But he's supposed to be a poon hound.
Well, he's got kids. He brought
his
sons.
Well, he's supposed to be like a woman. What do they call it? A
womanizer?
That, but not like... blah, blah, blah. I can't think of it.
Not bisexual.
No. He's like a woman's man.
The ladies love him.
Ladies man, yeah.
Ladies
he's
man.
Supposed to be like a ladies man, but he seems like the biggest queer you've ever seen. You could say queer.
He seems...
Fag's bad, queer's okay.
He seems like a douchebag in
real
life.
He's clearly a douchebag.
Yeah. He seems like... But he thinks he's a real good-looking guy, and he's just
slick,
like, get all the
funny.
Women.
Right.
I hate people like that. Real cocky, egotistical. But then...
I don't know anybody like that.
I was talking to my sister.
Not me.
I was talking to my sister. Absolutely. Yeah. I was talking to my sister.
I do
and
it
she
jokingly.
She says that she watches the show that and she says that although he may come across like that, and I've never seen the show, I thought... Here we go. You can make fun of me. But when I was watching the Today Show, I watched GMA and the Today Show every day.
GMA,
I thought
he's even got
in the third hour, where it's Willie Geist and Al Roker and Natalie Morales and Tamron Hall, right? The four of them.
The only one of the people I know is Al Roker.
I thought Weatherman. Willie Geist was the biggest douchebag. And then I started watching him, and I'm like, yo, you know what? He's an awesome guy.
I made reference to that in a recent column where I was talking about how I thought Jim Ross sucked doing MMA.
Right.
I was comparing it to... I was like, maybe if you watch him enough, it'll grow on you. Sometimes a different style takes a while to get used to. I remember Boss Rutten used to be our co-host an hour or two for the MMA after Ryan Bennett fucked us over. Mm. Rest in peace. He passed away. But, we had Boss Rutten and Steven Quadros as the announce team for Pride for the American broadcast. And I remember when they fired Quadros... Mm-hmm. They brought in this guy named Mauro Ranallo.
Yeah.
Actually, they first brought in somebody else. I forget his name, but he was a douchebag. What was his name? The dog something was his name. Anyways, when Mauro Ranallo came in, I was like, this guy is annoying as fuck.
Right.
He sucks.
Right.
Man, Kevin Randleman knocked out Mirko Koka. Right. Kevin Randleman. He sucks shit so bad, but...
He grew on you.
He's awesome now.
He grew on you.
He does the Mayweather fights for Showtime. He does, you know. He's great now.
Speaking of boxing.
But he hasn't changed that much, so it was just a matter of that I needed to get used to him.
Yeah.
So maybe if you get used to that,
you know. That's what happened with Willie Geist, is what I was
saying. That's what I'm saying. If you get used to it, eventually it's
so
like,
maybe
oh,
this
good.
Maybe this Todd Chrisley guy maybe. Is not all that bad. Maybe
the promos don't work for him, though. They make him seem like a douchebag's douchebag.
Right. But anyways, and not only that, but God... They flew the poor guy into Raw. They promoted all week that this guy was going to be the guest host of Raw. And then I put up on my Facebook page last night, that is a classic case of we have absolutely nothing for you.
Yeah.
We can't even figure out where to fucking put you. So go in the audience, we'll put you front row and promote your show, and we'll air commercials throughout
Raw. We'll ask you, what's it like to be here? What can we expect on this season of your show? And all right, thanks for coming.
So listen, we got to get back.
I was going to say, real quick, his interview, he carried himself pretty well. He didn't seem... I thought he was going to try and be funny and clever, but he was just very straightforward. Hey, my kids love it. My kids got to meet all their heroes. It's great. Fun being here. I was like, all right.
So we got to get back to we got sidetracked here, but so during Raw last night. So the one thing, like you said earlier, is the contract expired and they mutually agreed to
talking about Justin Roberts,
right. Back to Justin, and then
during the Ziggler Orton match, you said you didn't
there
get
were
to
a
it.
Couple of other fan reports that said during the Orton Ziggler match, Justin Roberts looked really pissed off. Did exactly what Boone just did to me to Michael Cole.
Maybe not that close, but
they were going back and forth during that match, and it almost seemed like something happened.
Did we find out why?
I don't know.
We're going to look into that.
We haven't figured it out. Yeah. But something happened between Michael Cole and Justin Roberts. Now, I don't know if after the show or on the headset, Michael Cole ran and told management and said, this guy's... He did this, he did that, we don't know what happened, but it seems to be that there was some sort of incident between Justin Roberts and Michael Cole at Raw, and if Michael Cole ran basically tattletale, on Roberts, and then they wound up firing Roberts. I don't know what happened. Maybe that's not the case. It may be as simple as, listen, contract expired, but...
That's what I was telling you.
I was telling you. He was the head guy.
Yeah, he was the main guy. He's the guy that.
He was good.
He was damn good,
Really good,
And he's the good looking guy, like they like. Yeah. Young guy. He's not old. Right. He doesn't have the southern accent. All that shit they hate. He fit the bill. But my thing was, and I told you off air earlier today, he's got a lot of tenure with the company. He's been here 12 years.
Yeah, that's true.
So you figure by now he's probably making good money. And they're doing hella budget
cuts. Got a couple
of
pay raises here and there.
Exactly. Over the years, his salary went up. So I figure the way they're doing all these budget cuts, and I mean, they're even cutting guys like Drew McIntyre, throws through these guys that are, have potential.
Right.
I figure they look at their list. Oh. They look at whose contract's coming up. Who can we do without? Which they could do without anybody they wanted to. They've proven that time and time again.
Right.
But
right.
The ring announcer, a guy who just says people's names, I know it adds a different. No, I don't. I agree with you. It adds a whole flavor to the show that if it sucks, it makes the show seem worse. If it's good, it makes the show seem better, like a good crowd or a bad crowd. But I think that he was making so much money, which I don't know for a fact, but I assume that after 12 years, his salary did this. And in WWE's mind, they're doing these budget cuts, and who can we do without, and this and that, whose contract's up. We could fucking pay any jerk off way less to do exactly what he's doing, and it could be, maybe not as good, but how fucking much worse could it be? That's just my opinion.
I don't know. I think it was the case. I think something happened. I think something happened at Raw. Okay. And
no, listen, I read all the Michael Cole stuff from fans that were at the show. It sounds like, and multiple
people. Sounds like something happened.
Wasn't one fan that sent this stuff in. There's multiple accounts, all basically saying the basic same thing.
I had two emails, and then various other websites said that
I only had one email, but I read a lot of other people's emails. Like, I've read the ones you put up and all that. So,
right.
And they all kind of said the same thing. Like, there was clearly something
some sort
going
of tension
on.
Between
and
those
and they all said it was during the Orton Ziggler match.
Right.
It was definitely between Cole and Roberts.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like one of those situations is where there's smoke, there's fire. Got to be something to it if that many people are saying basically the same thing.
I haven't gone back and watched Raw, but according to reports, Roberts...
Is it on camera?
Roberts flipped them off. I don't know. Was it on camera? And then the guy that after Raw went off the air, and Justin did the ring announcing at Raw last night, so after Raw went off the air...
Immediately after.
Kevin Dunn...
Like fucking 20 minutes after the show.
Kevin
boom.
Dunn
yeah.
was the guy that approached him and said, "You're fired." Kevin Dunn, who's the guy who's in the truck. He's in the truck doing the producing. Kevin Dunn is not normally the guy.
Like the big teeth.
Right, right. Wow. Kevin Dunn is not the guy that makes the phone calls and says you are fired. That's head of talent relations. I think it's Jane.
Goody or
Jane Goodis or something like that. She's the one that
is
makes
she the head of talent
the phone calls.
I thought Triple H was handling talent these days.
It would be Triple H, and I think Jane works directly under Triple H. Correct?
Okay, I don't know.
I think so.
Jane
think
Austin, Jane Goody, Jane Good.
Something
Jane good.
She's been featured on Total Divas.
Yeah, I've seen
that.
She got the dyke haircut.
I think Triple
Can you
H.
Say dyke? That's bad, right?
Yeah.
The lesbian haircut.
Right, right.
The butch lesbian.
Triple H, you're right. Triple H is head of talent relations, but the guy or the woman.
I know he's head of developmental.
That works.
Maybe that's.
That works directly under Triple H. But it was weird that Kevin Dunn would have been the guy to come up and say, Justin, you're fired. Now, of course, Kevin would have.
Maybe they weren't a lot together because he's production and this guy's.
And an announcer, something like that.
Yeah.
Maybe it was something.
Maybe
there was something on the headsets between Justin Roberts, Michael Cole, and Kevin Dunn.
Never know.
And Justin got frustrated. Something.
See, that's the kind of shit that, no matter how bad the product is,
yeah,
makes wrestling interesting. If you
get
a glimpse into that stuff, it's really great. Like, just like behind the scenes of Saturday Night Live. Like, we found out Bill Hader's.
Bill Hader was awesome this week.
You know?
He was awesome.
Sometimes,
did you see that
sometimes
Saturday
the
Night
shit
Live?
Behind the scenes is more interesting than shit on camera.
Oh, it always is.
Someone knocking on the door?
No, I just hit the
computer. Oh, okay.
Why
won't they tell us the name of this?
That's part of the reason you watch Total Divas. Is
the only reason.
There's a lot of behind the scenes stuff.
You see her with the seamstress.
Right.
With the short hair.
Right. And although it's scripted, if you watch closely enough, you can see guys, you know, walking in the background, talking to each other, this, that, and the other thing on Total Divas. But I think, and obviously more information is going to come out on this, but I think something happened. I think there's more to the story than they just, I mean, because he was their head guy on pretty much Raw and SmackDown. Of course, you've got Lillian Garcia that's there part-time. You've got Tony Chimmel, who's kind of part-time as well. But Justin.
Chimmel's full-time, man. Chimmel's
on SmackDown?
Oh, I don't know about TV. I know he does a lot of the house shows and stuff, but Chimmel's one of the most tenured employees in the history of the. Him and Howard Finkel are like two of the very few guys that were there when Vince Jr. took over.
Right. But I know
Chimmel used to put up the ring
Justin,
way back in the day.
Justin was on the road full time at WWE working live events.
He was the ring announcer.
He was the A team ring announcer.
Chimmel would be the B team
ring announcer. For them to just say, you know what, we're canning you after Raw last night. There's more to that story than what's out there.
We haven't plugged the chat room yet, and I gotta say, before you plug it, I'm disappointed in them this week.
Yeah,
you know why?
I am too.
We did that Jane thing. We're trying to figure out her last name.
Not
one person the same. At the same time,
no.
There hasn't been a new post, and it might be frozen or something.
We may be lagging here.
Yeah.
You've
got to think there'd be 80 people that Googled it, and I said it first.
I don't
know. It's kind of dead in there this week, too.
You know what, though? And I put this up on my Facebook page, man.
Traffic sucks today.
Traffic has not been good. It was to the point with advertising rates and traffic and everything. Else, and I don't want to get into this big old sour note, but I was
damn near crying one day.
Yeah, you know, I was thinking, how much longer am I going to be able to do this, you know, full time as a job? You know,
Jane, there
with the years to come. But all right, get to our live chat room, WZROnline.com/chat. You can follow that link. You can get in there. Lots of people in there, and
including
as always tonight,
Jerichoholic, who gave us the Jane Geddes. Is that how you say it?
And Robbie, aka Crazy Roller.
He didn't say anything, but he says
plug us.
Well, Jerichoholic gave us the answer we were looking for.
Thank you.
I wanted to plug him. I don't know how to pronounce that though. Jane Geddes. Good Geddes.
Jane Geddes.
You said Goodies, so we were close.
Goodis?
Oh.
It's Goodis.
Geddes?
Something like
Geddes.
That. But anyways, so that's the Justin Roberts story. The other, I guess, big story would be, you know, we talked about CM Punk, TNA reaching out to CM Punk.
By the way, we didn't mention, but he's not interested at all.
Not interested.
Like, they offered him the Hulk Hogan deal. We'll give you fucking tons of dough.
Right.
Or, what, a cheese, cheddar, Skrilla, lube,
Skrilla, cheese. Yeah. You know, you cut the cheese, and it looks like... Anyways,
that's cutting cheese.
Do you know that cheese?
Farts
are funny,
if you
eat cheese before you go to bed,
you have bad dreams.
That's
what you guys said. Yeah.
I heard you the other night. I woke up.
I remember I did a big.
Rah! Rah! It was like 4 o'clock in the morning, and I said, "What the fuck just happened in there? Did you have a dream?"
I don't remember what it was, but I've been having some fucked up dreams.
But you went, "What?" It woke me up, dude.
I've had some fucked up dreams lately. Yeah? It was a lion.
But you noticed when it happened.
I was walking home, and I went the wrong way. So I went into this building to ask these old ladies that were working for a ride home, but there was a lion in front of the door. Somehow I walked in, no problem, but when we came back out, the lady agreed to give me a ride. We came back out to go to the car, and there was two lions now, and they were fucking tearing the shit out of all of us. It was weird, man, and then I'm always able, when it gets real bad, like when the worst part of the dream's about, like the lion's about to bite my head off, I'm able to, in my head, somehow know I'm dreaming and say, alright, let me stop this shit. Yeah, I'm able to do
you
that.
You ever have the dreams where, this may sound weird, maybe I only have them, but the dreams where you're
falling?
You're trying to get away from somebody and you're trying to run, but you can't run. Like, you're
can't. Never had that one.
No, it's fucking weird, man. And
I've had ones where I can.
And then I wake up and it's
like, I've had ones all the time where I can jump real high. Like, I jump and I go way the fuck up, and then I fucking slowly come down, and then I jump and I go way the fuck up. Like, I got fucking springs in my shoes or something. Like, I can fucking damn near fly.
Alright, so anyways, the other big story over the past week, Kurt Angle. Kurt Angle. This guy,
There you go, John Morgan has him.
He is, you get those? See, yeah. I get those too, man, where you're trying to
run.
He
says, it feels like your legs weigh, like,
yes,
500 pounds.
They weigh 1,000 pounds, man. Yeah, no doubt. And you're trying to get away, and then it's...
Psychiatrist can tell you what it means.
Fucking weird, man. It's weird. Yeah. But anyways, alright, so Kurt Angle. This guy, I mean, y'all know Kurt Angle, right? Been caught in numerous lies.
Oh, it's true.
Listen, he claims that, and we knew that a couple of months ago, Kurt had contacted WWE, more specifically Vince McMahon, and tried to go over Triple H's head.
Oh, that's right.
Tried to go over Triple H's head and went directly to Vince. Basically, Triple H kind of gave him the, get out of here, everyone.
Yeah, not really.
And he went to Vince McMahon, that guy, word got back to Triple H. Triple H wasn't happy about it. Kurt is now claiming to friends and you know, family, people close to him, that WWE offered him a full-time deal.
Yes.
But he, a guy that wants to go back to WWE for one final run, he claims that, yeah, WWE, they offered me a full-time deal, but I turned it down.
Well, apparently he turned it down.
I turned it down.
Because he knows he doesn't want to go on the road that much or something. That's the story.
Listen, Kurt Angle is a beast. We know he's a beast. And I think this is Kurt's way of spinning it. WWE told him, yeah, we're not really interested in, because of the health concerns.
I've heard Vince McMahon has said,
does not.
I don't know if it's on the record or off the record, but I know that I've heard many people tell me Vince's big thing is, because Angle's a known drug addict, former, current, whatever. I'm not saying alleged, supposedly.
Whatever.
Know, maybe. But
Vince
does not want an Olympic gold medalist dying while working for
on
a company, because the media fucking storm that he would get from that would be atrocious.
Yep.
So, and he knows that Angle either has had his problems or still has his problems. I'm not accusing anybody of anything. He's had enough DUIs and enough drug test failures.
DWI, a couple of months ago, something to it there.
And he's got those eyes where you can tell when he's fucked up. When you look, he's got those blue eyes to
the
where
glazed,
where they get that glazed, glossy, smoky look, and the fucking droopy.
Tell by the way he's talking to, man.
Slurred
words and everything else, man.
So it's one of those where he's like, you know what? He's had his problems in the past. That's kind of why he doesn't work here anymore. I don't want to take the chance on that guy dying on my watch, because it would fucking kill us. The media would be atrocious.
Absolutely, absolutely. And not only that, but I think, you know, we know that Kurt went to WWE and tried to get an offer. And I think if WWE, I mean, listen, Kurt's been, he's openly admitted, I don't have much time left, but I'd like one more last run in WWE. If WWE offered him a full-time deal and said, yep, we want you, come on back, all you gotta do is pass the physical test, the wellness test,
I got news for you, he ain't passing that, by the way.
No, he's not. Yeah. He's not. And Kurt would have taken that deal. I think WWE basically brushed him aside and said, well, you know, you're kind of a... Whatever they told him.
Well, listen, the
and
story
I think
is that...
This is Kurt's way of coming out and trying to spin it in his favor, okay. saying, "Well, WWE, they did offer me a full time deal." Well, that, but I'm the one.
That's what I'm gonna add on to that.
Go ahead.
The full time deal thing. So the story goes, they know he's not interested in going on the road full time.
Yeah.
So they said the only way we'd take you back is if you'd be a full time player, knowing he would turn it down.
Right.
So it was kind of a polite way of giving him an offer that they're not really giving him because they know he's not gonna take it. We're not going to give you the limited schedule part-time thing that some guys like Brock gets, The Rock gets.
So do you think that WWE actually offered him a full-time
deal?
No,
I don't know. I have no idea.
I don't think so.
I have no way of knowing, but if I were to guess, I'd say it's possible. I'd say no.
I
gun to my head, I'd say no, but I have no idea.
With Vince's, the reaction that Vince has had in recent years to... Not recently. I mean, Kurt's been with TNA for, what, 8 years?
A long time. I can remember, like, it was yesterday. It was one of the best TNA shows ever.
Mm-hmm.
Biggest pops, other than Big Vito popping out of the back of the fucking ambulance.
God.
Just because we were buddies with him.
Yeah.
By the way, he's going through hell with his family right now.
Vito?
God bless him. Yeah, some kind of health thing.
Really?
He's been posting about it on Facebook, but I hope everything's good, man.
Yeah, good luck.
But anyways, yeah, we marked out when we saw him pop out of the ambulance. But the biggest one ever, and I think I was living with you in East Greenbush at the time, is when they show this video.
Yeah.
Out of nowhere, bam! American flag opens up and it's Angle, and you're like, holy shit! Because this one, TNA, was still the little engine that could or maybe wouldn't, but we're hoping can. And they never had a guy that level. You know, they had Raven come in. He was a big deal.
Yeah, that was their first.
But this was like a WWE main eventer in his prime still.
Right.
Jumping over, you know. And it was unexpected, shocking, and kept quiet. We didn't really even have rumors about it or anything. It was just out of the blue. Holy shit, Kurt Angle's here. And then they did the Angle Samoa Joe stuff, which, in my opinion, best angle they've ever done in the history of that company.
Yeah, that was
Kurt Angle smoked with the headbutt and the whole
thing. And the matches, too.
Unbelievable.
I mean, the series of matches that they had.
I think it was their highest buy rate ever, their first pay-per-view match.
Was it?
I believe so.
They get 9,000?
No, I'm sure. Okay. No, I believe it was like 30,000 or something.
Speaking of numbers, the WWE Network, on October 30th, they are going to release their numbers. Now, here's the deal. Listen. The
All
numbers.
Right, put your nuts out. Give me a number.
The numbers right now. Okay.
No.
The number
they're going to announce.
What are they at right
October
now?
30th.
What are they at right now?
What was the last number? 6
7 710 I thought it came 690.
Let's just say 700,000. We'll go in the middle.
700,000.
Are we taking calls?
Not yet. When they come out on October 30th, you've got to understand that they've launched overseas in several markets now.
Yes.
Canada and the United Kingdom? Not yet.
I don't know. Let us know in the chat.
700,000.
They rolled out a lot of international markets, I believe. So.
700. And then the 6 month subscriptions.
I thought it was all the way down to like 650 when we found the real number.
I thought it was 680 or 690.
695, I want to say, but that doesn't. I don't know.
All right, whatever. So we're going to say 700,000. We'll just go on.
Yeah, but a lot of those are up.
We'll go on the basis that it's 700,000.
But no, a lot of those subscription numbers. Those first 6 months, remember, for WrestleMania?
But those are going to expire. Those are going to expire.
So my point is, the 700 they announced, it's not like, oh, how much higher is it?
I know.
It's, did they get those fucking guys?
You ready? You're probably going to call me crazy. All right. So they've launched overseas, and we know that. And a couple of that's a big deal.
In theory, at least their expectations are they're going to double when they make it available everywhere else.
But they have also, you know, 6 months. That original subscription period has expired. How many of those people have resigned?
A lot of those people signed up just for WrestleMania.
I'm going to go at the max. At the max.
Remember, they offer 1 month subscription now. You don't have to do six.
True.
So it's not $60. You can literally do $9.99.
I'm going to go at the max. Keep in mind, we're at 700,000 now, somewhere around there. They've launched overseas, like I just said.
No UK till November, thanks to Winter's Lair.
No UK till November. I'm going to say, you ready?
Yes.
It's going to shock the shit out of
you. Go ahead.
850,000.
You know what?
850,000.
I'm not far away from you. I'm thinking.
I was going to say 900,000, but I dropped it even lower.
I'll say.
Dropped it even lower.
I'll say.
I may go 900,000.
820.
820.
I'll say 820.
You're lower than, wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
I think the people, I wouldn't be shocked if the number was lower than the last time they announced the number.
Because of all the original subscriptions.
Those people
and
signed up.
They don't have original content.
Those people signed up specifically to get WrestleMania for $10 instead of $70 or $65 or whatever the
fuck it
is.
They'll come back around next
year. Point being, they signed up just for Mania. So even if, alright, we sign up for 6 months because we have to, they don't have to anymore. Right. But even if they did have to, that 6 months still doesn't get you WrestleMania. So those people who signed up,
they're not
going to
sign up yet
for WrestleMania. They're going to wait.
They're
going to
wait.
Yeah,
they're going to wait.
So my opinion, I think they lost a fucking ton
with
that last week.
Subscriptions.
It was
expiring.
Last week when the WrestleMania ones came up.
Yep.
I say they lost a fucking ton.
I agree.
And I don't think they gained much with the international because I think a lot of the diehard, like we talked about,
they're UK.
The earlier we were talking about TNA diehard people who would watch Bound for Glory and or the traffic, like
right.
if they wanted to really see Bound for Glory or if they're a big enough fan to watch TNA, they're right. on the internet, they've read the spoilers, that's why your traffic sucked.
Mm-hmm.
I think the same thing with the network. As much as people don't want to believe it, a lot of those international people found out
mm-hmm.
how to get access to the network
right.
before it was officially available in their section of the world.
Can we both agree that the WWE Network, and whether people want to believe
failure?
It or not, it has been a complete...
Well, I say it's too early to tell.
Not a complete failure. I think the UK fan base, when it...
That's a big market, man.
That's a huge market
yeah.
over there. That's second biggest to
then
the
again,
United States.
So maybe Canada. Canada's huge.
It is.
So we'll see. On that'll be the big tell, October 30th. You know, if Canada can, the whole country is available there. Although, didn't they do it on TV there or something?
They had a problem with Rogers Canada. They wanted
to. It's so fucking confusing keeping up with all
right.
this shit.
They wanted to launch as an exclusive channel on television where people could order the network and watch it on television. Rogers in Canada just said, whoa, that's the major cable company like Time Warner. Rogers in Canada just said, whoa, that would put you in direct competition with the Fight Network, and we don't want that. So there's a problem with Rogers Canada basically saying, we've already got the Fight Network, and you want to launch something that's going to be in competition. So I think they're in negotiations right now to try to work through that.
I got to say, there's a lot of people in the chat saying that either they or their friends tried to cancel,
mm-hmm.
and it wouldn't let them. They automatically billed them anyway the next month.
Really?
A lot of people just said
really?
That. It, only if you order with a credit card, they're saying. But, I mean, I see six people that just said...
No refund. That's a refund.
Well, a lot of them just went away. They were up there. But a lot of people said that they tried to cancel, and then the first of the next month, boom, they were billed $9.99 anyway. Or it told them that they couldn't, one guy said. Like, there's a lot of people saying that you can't
cancel. Well, if you're signed up, if you get a six-month subscription, right, that's 6 months. So if you want to cancel 4 months out, you're already locked into a six-month subscription. So you've got to have it. Even if you cancel it, that's fine.
But what if you
cancel
your credit card? And they can't bill it because there's no such thing as your credit card.
Well, then they're going to come after you for... probably credit fraud.
Yeah, no, that's not credit fraud.
Or if they're going to find a way to somehow bill you, if you've got a credit card, you've got to put your address and everything else.
What if you get one of those
prepaid? They'll probably send you a bill in the mail to your credit card address.
But what if
you owe us?
Like I remember when I would get Western Unions a lot from bosses. They would offer you at Ace Check Cashing Center where I would get them cash.
Mm-hmm.
You could get a card and it would go straight to your card instead of having to go. Point being, the card acted like a credit card. It had the full number, it had the
right.
three digits on the back, it had the logo, the Visa or
mm-hmm.
MasterCard logo, the whole thing. If you
mm-hmm.
wanted to order porn online, you could use that card. It's
right.
not even a real credit card, and it's prepaid, so
mm-hmm.
you put a certain amount on it.
Right.
Once that amount's gone, it's done, and there's no paperwork or paper trail for they
but
can mail
because,
you in,
that's,
the, in
that's
the mail and
that's,
say, hey, you...
That's because somebody's already paid the cash for that prepaid card. Somebody's already given the cash.
Somebody's
that's
the person
paid,
that has
that's,
the card.
Yeah, but
I put the money on it. They say, how much do you want to put on this card? And I
right.
said, put $100 on the card and give me $200
but
cash.
But you've already given the money. They already have
that's
the money.
That's my point. So
okay.
if you had that card, and,
okay.
and let's say I was only getting $50, I'd say, put $9.99 on this card,
mm-hmm.
give me the other $30, $41, whatever the fuck the rest of it is in cash.
Okay.
So there's literally only $9.99 on this card. I go home, I sign up with a network using this prepaid
yes.
thing that acts like a credit card. Once that $9.99 is gone, and
right.
let's say it was still when you had to get the 6 month commitment.
Empty. Right.
Card's empty. I've got my fucking thing there. Well, it would have been $60.
They're going to trace it to the original person.
There is no trace, though. If you get it at Ace, like I got...
You've
got
to put in an address of some sorts.
Put a fake address.
Or you can put a fake address, but or how you many move. People do that? How many people do
what
that?
What if you yeah. move?
And I, who knows if they verify it, this, that, and the other thing. Yeah, it could be something
very
like
hypothetical
that,
thing. I don't know why I'm going as deep, but anyways, I was just wondering.
We need to get into Monday Night Raw. We got about 15 minutes before we go to the break. We'll start Raw. We'll come back on the flip side. We'll finish up Monday Night Raw from last night. Then we're going to be taking your rapid-fire questions, whatever you guys want to talk about, and your live phone calls as well. The phone number to call is 518-712-3070. Just give us a couple of minutes to get through Monday Night Raw from last night, and then we'll get into your live phone calls, like I said. Rapid fire and whatever else you want to talk about. Get to our live chat room, WZRonline.com/chat, the official home of WZR TV Tuesdays, WZRonline.com. We are on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube as well. Just go to Facebook.com/WZR Army, mm-hmm. YouTube.com/WZR Archive, and we're on Twitter as well. Go to WZRonline.com, top navigation bar, drop-down menu. It's got all the links to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. WZRonline.com, the official home of WZR TV Tuesdays. Bada-bing, bada-boom.
Well done.
Here we go.
Bada-bing, bada-mat-boom.
All right, Monday Night Raw from last night. Mm-hmm. Dean Ambrose. Dean Ambrose.
Yes.
I gotta tell you, man, I've always said all along, and I think you've agreed for the most part. I think early on, didn't you say Seth Rollins was the... No, you've always agreed Ambrose.
I thought Seth Rollins was gonna fucking sink. We talked about this last week when they split him up. I thought he was the one that would be in trouble. Dean Ambrose would always be fine because he can talk
Dean
and work.
Ambrose
and Roman Reigns, because he's the darling of management, would always
is
be fine.
Gold on the microphone.
It's amazing.
And this dude...
He's got a very... different style. There's not anybody else on the roster that has his style of promo or even his style of character in general. His ring style, like, he's very different.
He's got the,
gritty,
he's got
very
the,
yeah.
He's just the way his delivery, his facial expressions,
he's
everything.
He's crazy.
He's it was awesome, man. He comes out, cuts a promo about
he was doing that
John Cena shaking the microphone as he's talking. It was awesome. He said he promised to win the contract on a pole match at Hell in a Cell, and they kept saying over and over, in 2 weeks at Hell in a Cell, in 2 weeks at Hell in a Cell, I'm going in. Four reasons that we'll get into here in just a minute.
Done by design.
He wants John Cena to come out. And Cena eventually
comes
out.
And when he comes out, I gotta tell you, man, he had that line, I'm a veteran.
I'm a veteran, let me give you some advice.
Shut up.
Yes.
Be grateful. This, I was like, yo, what a dick.
It was.
Like, what a fucking dick.
You know, it was.
He's supposed to be a heel. That's great, because that's going to make people like, yo, what a stuck up prick.
Stuck up.
But he's supposed to be
a
baby, like a squeaky clean baby face.
Right.
Ambrose is the baby face that's got the edge to him. Cena's supposed to be fucking white meat baby face.
He said that something along the lines of, I've been to the top and to the bottom 15 times. I'm a 15
top
time
mountain,
world champion.
Yeah. I've scaled the mountain,
champion.
Whatever the fuck.
Da-da-da-da-da. But you're right, dude. It came across as just this snobby.
He says, let me give you, like, I'm a veteran.
I'm better than you.
Let me give you some veteran advice. Shut your mouth. Do it, blah, 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 and he was so fucking talking down
it
to
was,
him.
It really
he
was.
He was talking down to him like he's so much better than him. And listen, sure, that was done by design too, but
I'm
my
sure
question is, shouldn't it be the other way around? Like I said, Ambrose is a babyface, Cena is a babyface, but they're two completely different kind of babyfaces. Cena, squeaky clean, white meat. Ambrose, gritty, raw,
right,
crazy, loose cannon, but he's still a good guy, so he's got the edge to him. Cena should not be doing shit like
that. But I think the reason for that, dude, is, I mean, listen, half the crowd already boos Cena as it is.
Yeah.
The crowd loves the fact that Dean Ambrose is finally a guy, another babyface.
Give me a reason not to like you.
Ambrose is a babyface that's kind of stepping up and telling him what nobody else has told him. You know, having the balls to say, you know what? You're kind of a babyface. I'm a babyface. And more people like me than they do you, so...
When did he ever
get
say
him
that?
No, he didn't have that. I'm saying...
He gives off that impression.
He gives that impression off.
I don't
where,
get that, but okay.
Where I think it's great, man. I think that Ambrose is the type of guy who yeah, although he's a babyface, he's not afraid to get a heel reaction. He's not your
traditional babyface.
He's not getting a heel reaction. When he says these things about John Cena, he's not getting booed. The crowd pops. The crowd's like, yeah, we want to see Cena get his ass whooped by
him. He's like, the NWO and all that, the click. They were cool heels.
Right.
But they were heels because they would do heel shit. Ambrose is almost like, in this current role, like a cool heel.
Right.
But he's being pushed as a babyface because he beats up bad guys.
Right.
So he's a cool heel, but he's being used as a babyface. So you mix that all together, and it's a very different kind of babyface.
It's definitely different.
Especially for this era, where it's fucking very PG, very, you know...
It's
I don't want to keep saying the same phrase as squeaky clean. I'm trying to think of something else. But right. It's very squeaky
clean. It's definitely
clean, very PG, and he stands out because he's got that raw edge to him.
And after Cena was done cutting that promo about, you know, being a vet, and I've been at the top and the bottom 15 times, you know, Ambrose immediately replied with something along the lines of, well, let me tell you, Mr. Veteran, or something like that, which was awesome.
He even said, don't talk down to me, or,
whatever. Like, it's the same old Cena, you know, trying to give veteran advice, this, that, and the other thing. So out comes Triple H, right? Triple H, definitely. They're about to go at it, right? Dean Ambrose says, let's do it right now.
Yeah.
Let's do it right now. So the Authority winds up coming out here, and they make a bet, right?
Which we don't know until later, but it's for $1.
It's for $1.
Yeah.
Should have been for $9.99 if they wanted to continue.
They did a $9.99 cheap plug right there, too. It's so douchey. But.
So they make a bet where Triple H doesn't think that if they put him in a tag team match, the two of them teaming up,
he thinks,
and face somebody else, he thinks that they're not going to be able to coexist.
They're going
to
rip each other's heads
Stephanie
off.
Says, no, we put them together, you know, they're going to be able
to
make it happen. Right. So anyways, they set up a tag team match. It's going to be John Cena and Dean Ambrose against the Uso Brothers and Gold and Stardust.
The Dust
so it's
Brothers.
Basically
it's
two
a,
on...
They call it a triple threat tag team match, is what they called it.
Right. We go to a commercial break. We immediately go into that match.
Well, no, they had the Dust Brothers come out, and then during the Usos' entrance, we went to break.
All right, we go to break, we come back, and...
Ambrose and Uso.
Cena and Ambrose. Cena and Ambrose.
It was Ambrose and Uso started things off.
All right, I'm just going right to the end. I mean, it was a pretty good match, to be honest.
No, it was real good.
But the end of the match,
Stardust
Cena
was over in Atlanta.
He was.
We won Stardust. They were doing the chants and shit, and he started jumping up on the fucking bottom rope.
What did Big Show say backstage in a promo? They call it Hot Atlanta, right?
Yeah.
Big Show says, right here in Hot Atlanta.
Did he say Hot Atlanta?
No, dude. It's Hot Atlanta.
I thought he did say Hot Atlanta.
Hot Atlanta.
Did he say that?
He said Hot Atlanta. It was, I don't know.
Big goof.
All right, so they're able to coexist, right? And then, of course, Stephanie and Triple H, the Authority, come back out, and that's where it's revealed that, yes, it was a $1.
Yeah, here's your $1, you win, blah, blah, blah. But then they get to the point, and they announce the Hell in a Cell thing, and they say, later tonight, why wait till Hell in a Cell? Later tonight, no holds barred, contract on a pole, winner gets Rollins. And then later in the show, Randy Orton requests that the guy that loses the match, well, they never use the word loser.
Right.
The guy that doesn't win, give me him inside a cell.
Right.
So by the end of the Raw, we had two cell
matches. It got pretty confusing with this guy's going to face this guy on a pole, you know, contract on a pole match. You're like, Jesus, what is
anything on a pole is a bad idea. I don't know why they did that. Although, unless you're an 80s porn star.
An 80s porn star? Look at the stage she's got going on tonight.
Polls are great.
Through our live chat room, WZROnline.com.
I don't like saying it every time.
/chat. WZROnline.com/chat. We had our first of two Divas matches.
Was there two?
Monday Night Raw last night. We'll get to it here in a little bit. I can't remember. It was AJ Lee was involved.
No, this one.
Yes, it was.
There wasn't another one, was there?
It was Total Divas backstage with Danny Lee.
Oh, okay, you're right. Yeah.
So we had Layla and AJ, who are the new... Well, actually, it's Paige
What'd
and Alicia
you say?
Fox.
AJ Lee and Lele?
Layla. Lay-J is the name of their team.
Oh, okay.
AJ Lee
I think
and
that's
and
a joke the reporter made up. Lay-J.
Lay-J. No, they've been calling them that. JBL's
What do you mean they've been calling? It's the first time they teamed up.
JBL. No, they've been.
No, last week it was
SmackDown. They teamed up.
No, last week it was AJ and Emma, and then this week they even did a backstage interview. We're gonna.
There was something on SmackDown with Layla and AJ Lee.
I didn't watch SmackDown, but I don't know that. But I know on Raw, they referenced this is the first time these two are, like, who is AJ's partner going to be this week? Mm. They did a pre-taped interview where AJ says, I hate all the divas, but I hate you the least. Mm. You can trust me at least for one night, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
The uncomfortable hug they did.
Right.
And
right.
Yeah.
Anyways, so they teamed up against Paige and Alicia Fox. I mean, Alicia Fox recently had that gimmick where she was a loose cannon, right?
Throwing fits, yeah.
Yeah, throwing fits and everything else. And, of course, Paige has been in that gimmick in recent weeks where she's kind of a loose cannon as well.
She's like, her and AJ are crazy, but you never call them crazy.
Right, never call them crazy.
Yeah.
Right, so they teamed up Paige and Alicia Fox. Yeah. Right, frenemies, that's what it is. So what happens is, in the finish,
AJ goes to make the tag, Layla hops off the apron, walks away, AJ does a Shining Wizard, gets the pin anyway, and then chases after Layla.
Oh, to the back, right. Okay, all right, no doubt. We had Randy Orton. This is where Orton walks into the authorities.
The guy that doesn't win tonight's on a pole match.
Right.
Contract on a pole. Whoever doesn't win, give me them inside a cell, at Hell in a Cell.
Right.
And, yeah.
Triple H and Steph said it makes sense. Yeah. Let's do it.
And they keep doing these subtle teases. I've been saying for weeks. Randy Orton is turning. I'm telling you.
He's turning babyface, but when does it happen?
Sooner than later. I'd say within 3 months he'll be a good
guy. Yeah. A lot of people brought that up in the chat. We had a good chat turnout last night for
Better than Bound for Glory?
Much better than Bound for Glory. I mean, we...
Probably better than tonight.
Bound for Glory was terrible.
But yeah, so they like Randy Orton's idea. Yeah,
that's not as bad as the fucking fire alarm going on.
Fire alarm with Jake Shields.
During Jake Shields' interview.
Oh, Jesus.
Talk about douche chills. Twice it happened.
I know. And then on the archive, oh, it was clear.
Louder than it sounded in here.
And at one point, Jake kind of stopped.
He pauses like, yo, what the fuck is going on?
All right, we had Dolph Ziggler and Randy Orton.
That was a great interview.
It was, hey.
I wouldn't put the audio up. Hey, if it wasn't for If it wasn't for those two fire alarm spots, I would have put the audio up because I was proud of that. I did a pretty decent job.
You did a great job.
All right, I'll take great.
That was
pretty good. And then the fire alarms are like, I can't put that up. That's embarrassing.
Right.
Seems like you're in your mom's basement doing a show, which is the perception a lot of residents.
It happens. You're cooking dinner and the fire alarm goes off.
Your sister was cooking dinner.
There was no smoke out there.
She was making hamburgers that night, and then later in the week, we weren't doing a show. She makes hamburgers again.
Yep.
Fucking fire alarm goes.
There's something
with her and hamburgers.
There's no smoke out there, though. That's why I don't understand why the fire alarm went off.
I've never seen it, but yeah.
It's very sensitive. When you get done taking a shower, there's times where you open the door.
It always does. From now on, I leave the door shut when I come in here. If I leave that door open, because I take a hot fucking shower, but I've taken the fire alarm off my wall, if you haven't noticed.
Oh, Jesus.
It was going off one morning.
Oh, that's smart.
Well, it was going off real early once in the morning. I couldn't get it to stop. So I get up, I fucking hit the button. 2 seconds later, when I'm comfortable, about to fall asleep, lion's about to eat me in my dreams again, and then, bam, it goes off again. Jeez. I stop it. If I'm about to fall asleep, bam, it goes off again. I put it in the bathroom, I wrap it in a towel. A couple minutes later, bam, it goes off again.
One of these
times,
you cannot
get it to stop.
You're going to fall asleep with a cigarette in your mouth.
That happens a lot, actually.
It happens a lot, right?
Children. Yeah.
Right. So you pass out, you've got a lit cigarette, your room's going to catch on fire, and the son of a bitch rips fire extinguisher off, and you're going to die.
I'll feel it when it's burning my skin or something.
Unbelievable.
I'll be all right.
Dolph Ziggler and Randy Orton.
They already the first Wyatt thing. This time it focused on Eric Rowan.
Let's talk about this. You know what?
Mask and
we'll leave off of this before we go to the break. So there were two vignettes or two promos that aired last night.
Was there only two? I thought there was three.
I think it was two.
At least two.
I want to say two.
First was Rowan.
There was one.
Last week we should say it was Luke Harper.
Okay.
And then this week the first one was Eric Rowan.
Right.
And the second one was Bray mainly.
So the idea behind these is Bray is basically cutting them loose.
They're all going their separate ways.
But in the second vignette that aired last night, what looked to me like
I should have downloaded the Cena Wiz Khalifa.
What looked to me pregnant belly.
Had the written words,
it's coming.
Okay.
So it seemed to me like there was a pregnant belly, and then before that, Bray had referenced, "She'll be here soon. She's coming. She'll be here soon." And then the
Sister Abigail, with the empty rocking chair.
Yeah.
I saw that part.
And then right before it ended, there was a pregnant or a fat belly that said, it's coming, or she's coming, it's coming, something soon. Like that. So somebody's coming with Bray. Basically, it seems like Eric Rowan and Luke Harper are going to be set free. They're going to go to the separate
race. So who's Mr. Abigail
going to
be?
I don't know. I think there's a diva that's being called up to the main roster. Because
we've heard the Ascension, we've heard two rumors, at least I have.
The Ascension,
that there's talk of Harper going heel, Bray going face, Rowan who knows, but Bray aligning with the Ascension as his new guys, and then a separate rumor just came out yesterday or today that the Ascension's going to get called up real soon from NXT.
Right, we put that on
the website
today. Rocking
the pink
today.
Under the thing, I just noticed.
I did?
Yeah.
But it's, they're saying it was definitely a pregnant belly, okay. John Morgan in the chat, and it's coming, or who's coming.
Coming.
It's not Karma. I mean, Karma recently came out, did an interview, and said that, you know, she would have done Total Divas if she was offered. But somebody's coming with Bray. Basically, they're going to switch up the Wyatt family. The Wyatt family's no more, or new members of the Wyatt family are coming.
I had this. I wrote a note on this computer. I write notes when I come up with column ideas. Like, I write the title that I think of, and then, like, a little paragraph to, because I'm drunk usually, so I write, like, hey, boom. Dot, dot, dot. And then I write, like, a description of what my idea is so that the next day I can turn it into a column. Okay. Last night, it just hit me, and I can't believe it never hit me before. The Wyatt family, that whole gimmick, those characters in general, are, like, literally heels in the show True Detective. Have you ever seen the show True Detective? You don't watch. You do watch TV, but you don't watch good TV.
What's
you watch
True Detective?
You know?
I've never
it's an amazing, amazing drama on HBO, I believe. It was Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson.
Okay.
Were the two main guys. And then the bad guys are like this fucking fat guy. He's in the woods, this and that. Bray's always in the woods in these vignettes. He's fat. If you see True Detective, they really seem like they would fit perfectly as heels. And there's talk of, we talked about it last week, I think, the Sasuke twins?
Yes.
They want to make a Wyatt family
they
movie?
They asked the fans about making a Wyatt family movie. I'm telling you.
That would be a good movie.
WWE sources confirmed it. It's a takeoff. The original concept for the Wyatt family was the guys with the beards.
The Duck Dynasty.
Right. But then they went completely separate.
They really seem like True Detective heels. I'm telling you. They fit right in there perfectly with them.
All right, listen. You're listening to WZR TV Tuesdays with Scumbag over here.
Scumbag.
Matt Boone and Ryan Clark. We're going to come back. We're going to finish up Monday Night Raw from last night. Also, the live phone number to call us. We're going to be taking your live phone calls and rapid fire. 518-712-3070. Rapid fire. What's rapid fire?
It's a segment we do. Hour number two, where, like you said, we take your questions and comments and we answer them in a rapid style fashion. Now, if you want to contribute to said segment, pretty simple. You go to facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR, that's facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR. Once you get there, the top post will ask for your rapid fire questions and comments. We get now number two. We'll answer in a rapid style fashion. Thank you very much.
One line only.
Yes, please. God, please.
Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. You are listening to WZR TV
hopefully.
Tuesdays.
Yes.
With Matt Roo and Ryan
Pornstash. Matt Pornstash.
Ryan Clark.
Ryan 5 o'clock shadow, Razor Ramon Clark.
Yes,
and Matt Pornstash, Cody Rhodes, old gimmick, boom. We'll be back.
See you in a couple minutes. That's her.
Man.
Sit your ass down, man.
Pornstash!
Sit your ass down.
Pornstash!
How's that chicken?
Delicious.
It is delicious. I just, cheesy potatoes, bro. That's kind of our new thing, right?
Oh, man, me and my brother Mike, every fucking...
Oh, you used to eat these down in Florida?
My God.
Did you?
We wouldn't get the cheap ones. We'd get the name brand.
Right.
We'd get that, cube steaks. That's our dinner pretty much every night.
Dude, cheesy potatoes, if you've never had them. I think they call them like
scallop potatoes. They're cheesy scallop potatoes.
Oh, they are the most delicious...
They look like potato chips covered in cheese, but it's potatoes instead of chips.
You heat them up, or you cook them. You know, cook them on the stove, and you know, you mix them with some chicken or even hamburgers, whatever.
I don't
know?
Mix them with that.
That's just as a side.
Dish.
Right.
Absolutely. Dump a bunch of pepper on them.
Mm. I just had a couple bites of that before we came back on, man. You're still doing that. But, yeah, man, it's good.
Foam, foam.
Yeah, nice little belly guy you got there, huh? All right, so here we go. WZROnline.com/chat
Yeah, and I wish you pricks would get into the chat. Where
yeah,
is everybody?
Yeah, get in there tonight, man. I'm telling you, traffic on the websites is not good. So we left off with Dolph Ziggler.
If I could promote him on the sites I work for, that'd be fucking nice.
Yeah.
If you're listening, Mike.
Easy now. Easy.
Well, I love him, but I don't know why I can't promote my own fucking show.
He writes your paychecks.
So?
He writes your paychecks.
I can't plug a show.
I think he's got a little personal beef with myself.
It's not a personal
beef. I don't know what it is.
He doesn't like to do anything that helps somebody outside his network.
Yeah, I know.
If it doesn't benefit his network. No, even if it does benefit his network, but if it helps somebody else on the peripheral, like just coincidentally.
Right. Last time I heard, you know, I met him in New York City. He was a great guy.
He talks nice about you all the time. He likes you.
You know?
Yeah.
I got no problems with it. I just, there should be some sort of cross-promotion that we have here. And
you would think.
I'm down for it. I'm ready for it, you know? Hold off on that for 1 second. Hold off on the live phone calls.
That's international. You don't want to take that real quick?
You know what? It is international. Go ahead. Yeah. Caller,
what's up,
you're live on WZR-TV. Where are you from? What you calling about?
Hey, it's Dustin, your boy from Florida. I call every week, guys. What's going on?
From Florida. Justin from Florida. I know this guy. He calls every week. What's up, man?
Yeah, hey, what do you guys think? I know you brought it up earlier about the Orton heel turn. There was a lot of him and Seth Rollins getting in each other's faces last night. They came out during each other's matches, and Orton was, like, playing to the crowd a lot, and he was... and do you think, too, if he does go babyface, that that's the reason they're going to put him in with John Cena? Because going into that match, you know, I'm sure he's going to get cheered and Cena's going to get booed. If you put him in with Ambrose, Ambrose is going to be like the total face and Orton's going to get booed. So if you're going to turn him as a babyface in that match with Cena, I'm sure he can, you know, he's going to get some cheers out of that. But last night, I thought him and Seth Rollins were going to, you know, go at it a few times because it was all about him saying, hey, you know, Ambrose and Cena can beat him, you know, any night of the week and stuff like that. And then they came out during each other's matches. So I know the logical way to go was him and John Cena instead of Ambrose. But I'm thinking, you know, he's going to get a lot more cheers in that match. I
don't know. I don't know if they're going to do the Randy Orton babyface turn this quick. I mean, he's talking about, you know, it when you go into Hell in a Cell, you're going to have Dean Ambrose against John Cena.
No.
Dean
Ambrose and Seth Rollins.
Dean Ambrose and Seth Rollins and John Cena and Randy Orton.
Yes.
By
the way, they announced next week's Raw main event, 3-on-2 street fight handicap
match.
It's
right.
Ambrose and Cena teaming up again against Rollins, Orton, and Kane. Just
again, that same shit every week.
Yeah, no, it really is.
Alright, thanks for the call, man. We gotta open up the phone line. What was he saying?
I think they're gonna hold off the Randy Orton heel turn. I mean, I don't think it's gonna come as early as 2 months.
No, I said like 2-3 months. I think it's a slow build.
It'll be interesting to see the reactions that, you know, John Cena and Randy Orton gets, whether Randy Orton gets a babyface reaction going against John Cena, or, you know, and of course Dean Ambrose is going to get a babyface reaction against Seth Rollins. So we'll see what happens, man. Caller, you're live on WZR TV. What's up?
Oh,
hey!
Perfect timing. We're getting into the Rusev stuff.
What's up, Jackie? Jackie?
Nothing much. Just been busy the last couple of days.
Yeah, what's been
busy
going
with
on?
What?
Me and my grandma have been crocheting. We're working on a baby afghan the other.
Oh,
hopefully we'll get it done. Hopefully we'll get it done soon.
All right. All right. You and grandma are doing what?
We're crocheting.
Crocheting.
Like
gotcha.
Knitting or something.
Knitting. Okay. Right. Right. No doubt. So what do you want to talk about this week?
Well, let's see here. Why did the Big Show knock out my favorite Russian in front of his girlfriend and made her cry, make her start crying her eyes out? Simple, because his brother from another mother stuck his nose in where it didn't belong.
Unbelievable. I know what you're talking about.
Oh my god!
Last night on Raw, and you know that we just put it up on the website that they are going to do the big show against Rusev at the Hell in the Cell pay per view. But Boone, what Jackie's talking about is last night during Monday
Who
Night
cried?
Raw.
What?
Lena was on the outside. She was on the outside. Well, she wasn't necessarily crying, but she was yelling and screaming after Big Show. I mean, it was basically Rusev in front of the announcer's booth. And Mark Henry came around on one side. Big Show came around on the other side. There was no escape route for Rusev. And he goes after Mark Henry at first.
Fucks up Henry.
And then he comes after Big Show. Big Show hits the knockout punch. And poor Lena was on the outside screaming and yelling that Jacqueline's hero, Rusev, was knocked down and knocked out. But they are going to do a rematch. You know, they are going to do Big Show and Rusev at Hell in the Cell. So, I don't know. I got to be honest with you. I think Hell in the Cell is the Big Show's night.
Well, okay. Here's the thing, though. You know, like I said in the past, I don't know why everyone has such a problem with her and Rusev. They're not bad people. I'm probably the only one that likes them.
They say, Jackie. Every week, all they talk about is how America sucks. Do you live in America, Jackie?
Yes,
they're bad people.
I do live in America, but I also respect Russians.
Okay, I can respect Jackie. I can respect Russia, but I don't say Russia sucks every week. And if I did, and you lived in Russia, wouldn't you think I'm a bad guy? You just said they're not bad people. They say America sucks every week. That's bad, Jackie.
If you lived in Russia, Jackie, don't you think, like, if you lived in Russia, and the Big Show was coming out every week and he was saying Russia sucks,
yeah,
Russia's garbage, wouldn't you be
fuck
a little
Vladimir Putin, Obama's the man.
Wouldn't you be a little bit pissed off if you lived in Russia? I think that's the
most definitely, and so would my high school teacher's brother-in-law, because he grew up in Moscow, because he played for
Moscow.
The NHL for a very long
yes.
time, and I'm like, okay, you know, enough is enough, you know.
I love Jackie.
I love her, too. She
but, okay, so, I'm sorry, I interrupted you. You were in the middle of making a point. Finish that up, and then we got to get running, Jackie.
Okay, I'm just saying, you know, let's just see what happens. I will talk to you guys next week.
Yeah, we're gonna have to see what happens at Hell in the Cell. Like I said earlier, Jackie, I think they're gonna do Big Show and Big Show and Rusev coming up in a couple of weeks at Hell in the Cell. So we'll see what happens. I mean, if Rusev wins there, then we'll see. We'll see if they continue the angle. You know what they may do? They may do a tag team match where after Hell in the Cell, if they continue the feud, they may be like, you know, Big Show and Mark Henry.
I think Henry's turning heel.
Henry
heel. By the way, I think that's coming. Yeah.
Yeah.
By the way, go Lions.
Now wait,
Jackie.
Who would tag with Rusev? And I don't know anyone who would want to, quite frankly.
Yeah.
All due respect with Rusev and Lana.
Yeah.
Okay, I will talk to you guys next week.
All right, be good, Jackie.
Go Lions.
Have a good week, Jackie.
Thank you.
All right.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Love that girl.
She is awesome.
I love that girl.
She is awesome, man. Yes. We love our Jackie. We love
she
our
loves
Jackie.
Wrestling.
By the way,
she loves
NFL this week. So check this out, brother.
Okay.
Check this out. In Dan's Fantasy League, I lost fair and square. Matthew Stafford.
I forgot to check. Did I win?
You won in Dan's League,
yes.
And you lost in
WZR. I don't care about
WZR
League anymore. Dan's
right.
League is the one I want to win.
All right. So here's the deal. Okay?
Mm-hmm. You're sure I wanted Dan's? I know I was winning.
Yes.
He had one
yes.
guy left.
Yes.
He had a
yes.
tight
yes.
end on Monday.
Well, we can check it right here.
He had a tight end playing last night. I didn't check, though, so I don't know. And he was pretty far behind.
No. You wound up winning last night, man.
I made the right choice in starting Greg Olsen
is this
over.
It right here? This will probably
I have
be it.
No
right.
idea.
We can check for you. Yeah,
all right.
140.
One
right.
by 12 points. Okay,
so
cool.
I wound up over here. I lost my game to this guy.
So
not
I am
only that,
2-4. You are 2-4.
All right, so we're both 2-4.
Yes.
I lost in Dan's league, and then
but you put up a ton of fucking 157.
See,
would beat anybody.
Anybody
except
for
this
one,
guy
except
and that
for one
guy.
Guy.
Except for two guys.
Two guys. Okay, so it's like one of those things where I've got the
that's
highest score.
Painful, man.
I've got the highest score.
That's
one of the
painful.
Highest scores in the league.
Yeah.
And then
that hurts.
And then
because that means you had a great week. It just happens that it just so happens the one guy you played had the best week.
Right, you exactly. Know? It's his team killed it the one week that my team also
killed it.
That was
the highest scorer in the entire league.
And then let's go to the WZR league for a brief minute because winner's lair, I got a bone to pick with you, brother.
I believe he left. Oh, that was John Morgan.
So, winner's lair in the chat. I decide this week that I am going to bench Tom Brady. He hasn't been doing shit. I'm going to bench Tom Brady, and I'm starting Joe Flacco.
For the first two quarters, it seemed like you're a fucking genius.
And I'm a genius.
That has a crystal ball.
Genius, bro. And Joe Flacco, he throws 5 touchdown passes. He's got 350-something
like
yards.
Or something.
He's put up 75 points or something
it's
like 75 points.
What a great decision you made.
What an awesome
And Tom decision. Brady, by the way, by at the same time, when he had already had the 5 touchdowns for Flacco, he had already had 60 or 70 points. Tom Brady, at the same time, 2 quarters in, just like Flacco, 70 points deep.
Absolutely.
Tom Brady's only got like 15, 18 points. And then what happened?
I go and I check at the end of the game. And although Joe Flacco put up a nasty...
Any other week, that'd be
nasty
amazing.
70, 75 points. Tom Brady, because I've got bonuses. I got bonuses set up.
Yeah.
You throw a 40 yard or more touchdown pass, you get a 10-point bonus.
10?
Tom Brady.
You need to change that. That's too much.
Tom Brady. I can't change it now because we're in
Then that was a stupid
10-point
bonus. 10 points is a lot.
A 40-yard touchdown pass is a lot. That's damn near half the field.
You get 4 points for that as it is.
Damn near half the field. You get 6 points for the touchdown, but you get a bonus.
Touchdown.
40-yard touchdown passes don't happen all the time.
Yeah.
It's not common.
Well, 4 points is pretty good for one pass.
Tom Brady winds up putting 105 points. 105
He is right. He benched Ty Hilton. And
he did bench T.Y. Hilton.
Did that.
Not Ty Hilton. T.Y. Hilton.
Is it T.Y. Hilton?
T.Y. Hilton.
Okay.
But anyways.
Whatever.
And I started T.Y. Hilton and dancing.
I know.
So anyways, I go into Monday night last night, right? And I've got like a 60-70 point lead on winner's lair, right? 60-70 point
lose.
Lead. He's got Colin Kaepernick, you know, his quarterback going, who's supposed to put up, you know, 40 points.
30, 40 points.
30, 40 points. And he's got a kicker going. I log in last night, and Colin Kaepernick puts up something like 80 points or something.
Whatever it was.
And the kicker puts up 15 or something.
Did
he? And winner's lair winds up beating me in the WZ. I don't know how it happened. I have no idea how it happened, because going into Monday night, I thought for sure there was no way, and I was even mocking him on Twitter. I'm on Twitter, and I'm saying, I got you with Joe Flacco, I'm kicking you, this, that, and the other thing. And the motherfucker
you spoke too
beat
soon.
Me. The motherfucker beat me.
He's good. Winner's Lair's good.
Winner's Lair, kudos, bro.
Is Rod going there tonight? Scroll down a little bit.
I got beat fair and square, man.
I wonder if he still tunes in every week.
I got beat fair and square. I got beat fair and square there last night. But anyways, here we go. WZROnline.com.
Motherfucking dot.
/ chat.
I like
WZROnline.com / chat. Get in there. Lots and lots of people in there, as always, tonight. All right, back to Monday Night Raw from last night.
We left off with Orton and Ziggler.
Yeah, that was an awesome match.
Yeah, Cesaro on commentary. Great match. Seth Rollins comes down during the match. Story of the match is, the story of the finish was, Orton gets the win over the IC champ, clean, with a crazy RKO, which was supposedly him paying homage or homage, because he's kind of turned into this viral internet sensation.
Yeah, I saw that today.
Where anything cool, like a big hit, or they throw the RKO over top, like kind of like Jim Ross.
Right.
When they throw his announcing over, like if somebody trips on the sidewalk.
Oh my God, they've killed him!
You know, it's one of those internet sensation viral things.
Right.
So apparently he had the idea to give the fans a killer RKO specifically. Mm-hmm. In that match to kind of tip his, you know, cap to the
cap
fact that,
them.
Yeah.
Right.
So that was that.
Rollins comes out, right.
After the match, Rollins comes in, hits his finish, the curb stomp.
Curb stomp.
On Ziggler.
I'm surprised they do a curb stomp on PG television.
And then they flip the script, and later, not much later, I forget who it was, Seth Rollins and Jack Swagger.
Right.
Long story short, Rollins wins the match. Orton comes down during the match, just like Rollins did to his match.
Mm-hmm.
And after the match, Orton comes in. Does his finish on Swagger.
Right, right.
And it's interesting because Rollins and Orton are not working a program. It's the exact opposite.
Mm-hmm.
Rollins is working Ambrose. Orton's working Cena.
Yeah,
they're on the op, but they're doing this program less. Right. I was trying to figure out what the point of that was. I couldn't really figure it out. I think it's just a case of more slow builds
for Orton. To that Orton babyface turn. I think Justin from Florida's back. Caller, you're live on WZR TV. What's up?
Hey, how you doing?
How you doing, man?
It's not Justin.
I'm good. Which one am I talking to with the hat on?
With the hat on? Whose hat?
Yeah. I'm seeing a live stream, and one's got a hat on and one doesn't.
Yes.
Okay, I guess you're Ryan with the hat, right?
I'm Ryan with the hat. Yes, sir.
Okay, Ryan, I wanted to ask you a question.
Yes, sir.
And like Matt Boone called it, I think Mark Henry's going to turn heel because it sets up perfect. But here's my question. Are you kind of nervous, or because I am, I love TNA. Are you nervous about them not getting a deal that everybody's starting to get apprehensive around them now?
You know, it is keep them on the line. It is interesting. There are people within TNA that, you know, say that a television deal is expected. I mean, if you're asking my thought, I think that TNA's probably got something lined up. I think going into 2015, we're probably going to see a new television deal.
As Spike?
It's not going to be as strong as Spike, but my feeling is that we're going to see some sort of announcement from WGN.
Do you think it's WGN?
Probably WGN.
Okay. That's as strong as Spike, by the way. It's very close.
It's a difference of markets where I don't know that, like in Albany, here in Albany, New York, yes. I don't know that we get WGN.
I know we got it in Florida where I live.
Right, so right. There are certain markets that, you know, people have WGN.
But from what I hear, I don't remember the numbers, but I know like Spike's in so many million homes.
They're right there with numbers.
As far as cable clearance, yeah.
I think within the next, you know, it could come as early as this week, if not this week. But yeah, okay. By the end of 2014, I think we're going to see a new television deal announced by TNA. Where that is, like I said, remains to be seen. But I'm thinking WGN America.
I agree.
We'll have to wait and see what happens. But if they don't get a television deal, I mean, that's the future of that company. I mean, TNA's future depends on a television deal. They're not going to make enough money to survive based off merchandise sales and live events and house shows.
They make no money off of licensing,
right?
Like merchandise, video games, whatever.
Right.
They make fucking jack shit. They lose money when they do live events.
Right.
They don't make anything on pay-per-view. Literally, their only revenue stream is the television rights fees they get. So the question is, not do they get another TV deal. Not as this TV is in available as many homes as Spike. The question is, what is the rights fee they get for this TV deal? Okay, let's say WGN and Spike are equals as far as cable clearance. You can watch it in the same. What are they getting paid to be on whatever network? If it's WGN we're talking about, let's say it's WGN. What are they getting paid on WGN compared to what they make now with Spike? Because what they make now with Spike is not enough for them to really grow. So if they go down in pay, which you have to assume they're going to because they have no leverage whatsoever. It's not like, we're not going to sign with you if you don't give us this much money. And they say, well, fuck you. What are you going to do? You know, you have no other legs to stand on. So they're going to go down in money. If they go down considerably, like a considerable amount, the company's going to be a very different company than we know it now.
Absolutely.
Or have known.
They're going to have to cut back. What Boone's saying is, you know, if they get a lot less money than what they're getting now from Spike TV, they're going to have to do a lot of cost cutting, you know, which is what WWE's doing now as far as production, as far as talents, flying people in from city to city, television tapings, this, that, and the other thing. And that's part of the reason why, you know, right now TNA's taping television months in advance.
That's exactly what I was going to say. If they knew the new WGN, part of the budget cuts would be to make it a consistent thing to where we're not taping every week, we're not taping every other week, we're going to tape months in advance to save on production costs.
Saves a lot of money. When you tape months in advance, you've only got to fly the guys in for one or two nights. Right, and the production, and the 18-wheeler trucks and everything else. So you tape everything right there in that one or two nights, as opposed to every single week doing a live show, you save a ton of money by doing that. And that's part of the reason why TNA's doing that right now. But to answer your question, I think we're going to see a new television deal from TNA by the end of the year. Where it is remains to be seen, though.
Okay, I got a statement and then a comment. I'm going to hang up and get your opinion.
Okay.
You know, thank you for taking my time. I want y'all to have a blessed day. But I want to say this, and I'm going to hang up and I want your opinion. What do you think about Superstation, WTBS, and TNA? Thank y'all and have a blessed day, man.
Hey, right. Thank you, too,
all right,
man.
Be good, man.
Great caller, great caller.
What do you say, Superstation?
TBS.
Oh, TBS.
Well, what about TNA on TBS? Absolutely not.
Absolutely I mean, that's Turner, right?
Yes.
That's
well,
broadcasting.
AOL, Time Warner, Turner, whatever the fuck.
Yeah.
But they do not. They do not want wrestling.
Turner is not getting back into pro wrestling. A lot of people. I mean, pro wrestling. A lot of advertisers look down upon pro wrestling. They don't want to advertise with pro wrestling. That's part of the reason why a lot of companies are unsuccessful.
Well, that's not only that. You know how you have empty calories when you eat, like, shit food?
Right.
Like, all right, you've just eaten a bunch of food.
Where are you going with this?
Point being, the wrestling audience, like, let's say you get, like, WWE, you get 4 million viewers, 5 million viewers a week.
Right, right, right.
It doesn't translate with the commercials you want. Like, your audience might be huge, but they're not buying Schick razors. They're not buying, you know, whatever you're selling with these commercials.
Exactly.
The audience might be enormous, but it's the wrong demo. So the commercials, although they're getting seen by a lot of eyeballs, it's the wrong demo of eyeballs because
the eyeballs aren't buying.
They're not buying
the product.
Yes.
That
so
that
it's not worth
seeing.
It for a
right.
big company like Pepsi or whoever the fuck
right.
to buy ad time, even though you're guaranteed to reach 4 million eyes every week. It's not going to translate into
it's
sales.
Not translate
so it's a
into
total
sales.
Shit buy for the you know the sponsors.
We had Rusev and Big Show. We talked about that with Jackie, where they came around each side after the match.
We covered all
they
that.
Attacked. Miz defeated Sheamus. By the way, two new WWE Hell in the Cell matches. Real quick, we talked about Big Show and Rusev earlier, and Miz against
Sheamus
for the.
Yeah, and we got Bree and Nikki, and the loser has to be the bitch of the winner for a month.
Yep, they announced
that. We got
last
the
night.
Two Cell matches: Cena and Orton, Ambrose and Rollins. That's the card so far, but
that's it so
the
far.
The Miz, who did he fight? Sheamus?
Last night on Raw, right. One,
can I just say,
be a count
Damian stand up?
He's
I'm going to
awesome.
Fucking stand up and applaud this motherfucker. Come here. He's amazing, bro. How awesome is
going.
It watching him fight an imaginary person on the floor, mimicking what he sees Miz doing, whether it's selling or doing offense, and he's doing it on
it
the
is.
Floor by himself.
You know,
it's fucking awesome.
You know, when you
it
guys,
is so fucking awesome.
When we watched
I love
that,
it.
When we watched that on television, to be able to go out there in front of 10,000 people on national television and perform a gimmick like
Man.
He does to a T like that.
Like when he did Fandango the one week and he
so,
did the, yeah.
It is so much harder. I mean,
interpretive dancing.
It's easy for us to sit there and watch, okay? It's easy for all of us to sit there and watch somebody do that.
He's dropping elbows
but
on nothing
about,
like
if,
Ric
if,
Flair.
If you're him and you're performing that gimmick, he plays it to a T. You've got to give. He is such a good actor.
Quick example. He's got a great comedic sensibility.
Absolutely.
Put it this way. In the ring, Miz is in an armbar from Sheamus.
Right.
Outside the ring, you see Sandow.
He's
just
got
he's got his arm wrenched backwards. Nobody's touching
it's
him, but
awesome.
He's going, ah,
it's
ah.
Awesome.
He's selling like a son of a bitch. He's
right.
doing elbow drops on the ground.
Right.
I mean, it's, and if you look, it's in sync with what you're seeing in the ring.
He's good,
so
man.
It matches perfectly.
Right.
It's so fucking funny.
You know,
it's so fucking
and
funny.
We don't know exactly
Sorry
what Damian Sandow
yes.
did. I mean, to be in the doghouse like this.
Yeah.
Talk
about a guy making the most out of whatever
out of
given
what
him.
He's given.
Hey, you're gonna
Absolutely.
Be Fandango tonight. You're gonna do interpretive dancing. Fucking bodysuit and the whole
they
thing.
They had him in the tan bodysuit that
flesh colored
like
bodysuit. He did
right,
the
right.
anything they give him, the shittiest of the shit, he will take. What do they call it? Chicken shit and turn into chicken salad or whatever
yeah.
that expression
yeah.
is. He is
right.
amazing.
He's awesome.
Which makes me think, and I don't know why it doesn't make anybody in WWE think, and I get passionate about this because I love Damian Sandow.
You are pretty passionate.
I think he's so fucking good.
He's
it's
good.
Scary how good
he's
he is.
He's good, man.
If he can take something that is atrocious, fucking terrible, horrendous, bad,
right.
and make it good, tolerable,
entertaining.
Acceptable,
right, right,
entertaining,
right. Right.
imagine, if you will, if they gave him something good, how great it would be. If he can take shit and make it great, Imagine how good it would be if you gave something
if he
good.
Could take chicken shit and make it into chicken salad.
Yeah, point being, imagine if you gave him chicken salad.
Right.
He'd turn it into the most gourmet steak dinner you've ever had.
Absolutely.
You know what I mean? Like, he's amazing.
Exactly.
His gimmick in general, the arrogant, rich, I'm smarter than you, snob, Triple H version 2014.
What put him in the doghouse, though? I mean, the last I heard,
I don't know.
He was at WrestleMania.
He's a company
guy, too.
He
didn't want any press for it. He was out giving money and food to homeless people on the streets during WrestleMania weekend. Didn't want any press. And then we found out after the fact that when the story leaked online that a couple of fans had spotted him handing out money and food to homeless people, he was upset that the reports leaked out online because he didn't want that out.
Like Bob Backlund does
it
a lot.
It was unbelievable.
Yeah. But I remember he did it.
Somebody that you've got to have.
Big time.
So,
big time, man.
Awesome, man.
And I remember watching him do an interview with Sam Roberts. Anytime Sam Roberts gets his hand on a wrestler,
Sam Roberts is the... him and Peter Rosenberg
from
are
Hot
the
97.
Two best interviewers in the business.
My boss is actually buddies with Peter Rosenberg.
Yeah.
But
awesome,
I remember Sam Roberts. They're in like a, they're on a couch at like an airport or a diner or a restaurant or something.
Yeah.
And Sandow is like half in character, half out. Like, he's giving Roberts what he wants,
right?
But he's still towing the company line the whole time. He is a company guy.
He
works his ass off. He's good at whatever you give him.
Mm-hmm.
Well, why not give him something?
Right.
He is this generation's...
He's that good.
Zack Ryder.
Yeah.
Everybody loves him. He's great at making something out of nothing.
Right.
You give him nothing, he still gets over. Absolutely. Fans are chanting Sandow's better. They're doing the whole thing.
They did it 2 weeks ago, right?
Last week. And they don't give him anything. Why?
All right.
When the year started, he was Mr. Money in the Bank.
He was.
Challenging John Cena in his return match. Cena's return from injury on Raw.
Ever since they threw the briefcase in the river there, right?
Yeah,
that's when it all ended, man.
He even had the leather brief, like the more professional looking brief. Like, goddamn, he's so good. It's such a shame.
We had a main event of Raw. It was Dean Ambrose. Basically, the moral of the story.
Well, we had the other Wyatt thing real quick.
We already talked about that. Was
this
the one
was Bray?
That was the one.
Yeah, we did talk about it. You're
right. Pregnant belly came out.
Yeah.
All right, Dean Ambrose main event. Basically, he overcame all the odds. Right, Kane came out, interfered.
Yes.
Seth Rollins came out.
Yeah, Triple H and Stephanie everybody side.
Right.
And then during the match, Orton and Kane came down.
Right.
And then a big schmoz happened, and while Cena's fighting everybody off, Ambrose climbs up the pole, grabs a kind. Well, he actually waits. He stands there and waits.
It was kind of an anticlimactic ending.
Anticlimactic,
no?
Very much so. Very
right?
much so.
Because right?
you're waiting to see what's going to. And then Ambrose is standing there. He's whenever he wants, he can pull it down, but he waits for Cena to finish beating up everybody that's interfering. And Cena turns
around.
He looks at him and smiles. Like, yeah,
right.
I got you, motherfucker. He yanks it down.
And there was no pop from the crowd.
Cena,
yeah, everybody
Cena,
was... Right.
No, Cena started, oh, yeah, you got me. Like, he's happy that he lost or something.
Right.
And then they do the stare downs. Rollins is on the ramp. Ambrose is staring him down. And Cena and Orton's
outside
the ring.
They did a double stare down. Right. Between the guys that are going to face each other at Hell in a Cell.
And
so overall, Monday Night Raw from last night.
Now, listen.
If
we're looking at what we expect from Raw nowadays...
Yeah.
It's a B.
A solid B.
Solid B.
I agree with that.
If you look at Raw from my perspective, which is a very specific, unique perspective, because
I've been watching the Monday Night Wars.
Because I've been watching back when it was in its heyday,
right.
And then you turn on and watch that shit, the 3 hours is what kills it. There's enough cool stuff in that show we just ran down.
Right.
To where if they had to squeeze it into 2 hours,
right,
it'd weed out the Nene Leakes. It'd weed out the Chrisley. It would weed out the bullshit that sucks.
Right.
And we'd have nothing but good, entertaining TV for 2 hours.
All right, so we're going to get into rapid fire. We've got a lot of them tonight, but we got about 15 minutes, then we're going to get out of here.
Yeah. Live a little longer. SmackDown's an hour behind.
It is an hour behind tonight. 518-712-3070. 518-712-3070.
Hello? Am I on the air?
Give us a call one more time. 518-712-3070. Give us a call live tonight.
Hi, I'm on here. Hi, guys. I'm a big fan.
We will mix in rapid-fire questions.
Turn down my radio? Okay, go.
We will mix in rapid-fire questions and your live phone calls as well. So, I made a point tonight to put one line only, please. So, with that being said, one line only, please, with double stars around it.
Can't miss it.
Takes us to the first comment.
The very first one.
The first question of the night. One line only, please. Go ahead.
Okay, I'll answer this one because it's directed at me. And
can you do one line only, please?
It's somebody not being able
to
take a joke.
Can you read this man's comment
One a little backstory. Remember how I told you I made a post on Facebook, just what we talked about. I've been watching Monday Night War, this and that, Raw, if you took it in a time machine, it sucked.
Why don't you read the question?
And I'm giving explain. You the backstory, because I basically the comment I said was, what do you get a Purple Heart for? Getting injured in the line of duty, ...
terrible.
Where's my Purple Heart for doing 3 hours of play-by-play of this piece of shit every week? Basically saying...
That's kind of disrespectful.
No, you just read it. Shut up, man.
No,
it's clearly a
what's
joke.
The comment?
Am I being serious when I say that? I'm clearly kidding. Clearly kidding. And I guess a bunch of people are offended.
Wait a minute, dude. Wait a minute. No.
There are
people in the army,
yeah,
and
okay.
Do you know what a Purple Heart is?
Yes, dickhead. Yeah, you get your fucking leg shot off or something, and you go home, you
right.
get a Purple Heart. Yeah.
That's people defending
I'm
our country.
Aware. Do you know
okay.
what a joke is?
Did you put, I'm only joking?
I thought it was kind of obvious. Do I really think I deserve a Purple Heart for doing a Raw play-by-play?
I don't know if that's...
Is that a serious statement?
Well, read Jay's
Where's
question.
The,
I think I agree with Jay.
Well,
I wouldn't make a joke. I wouldn't make a joke about
well,
a Purple Heart.
I did you hear
you're
the
You're comparing a Purple Heart to Raw play-by-play,
that's
bro.
The
a Purple
joke.
Heart.
Holy shit, do you not get it?
It's not something to joke about. A Purple Heart where somebody gets a leg shot off and is paralyzed for the rest of their life is not something to joke about.
Okay.
I agree with Jay. Read his question.
Well, that's fascinating. Jay Mullen says, Boone, were you seriously asking? And there you go, right there. Was I seriously asking?
Oh, hopefully not.
No, you motherfucker.
Well,
of course
I'll make
not.
A joke about that.
Jay Mullen's a good guy. I see him every week. Boone, were you seriously asking for a Purple Heart, he put in quotes, because you were doing a 3 hour long play by play for a wrestling show? Tons of people found that disrespectful, myself included. Perhaps find another job if it's too much of a hassle. I usually agree with you, but man, ...
I agree.
I don't need another job. I'm right. happy with my job. I just was joking that this show sucks. It's a pain in the ass to sit here and be forced to watch a 3 hour show that I don't like watching. So jokingly I said I should get a Purple Heart because it's like getting injured sitting here. It's a fucking joke.
We could go on and
do I really think the military should send me a Purple Heart for doing play by play of WWE?
Of course not. We could go on about this all day, but I gotta be honest with you, man. You're taking it a little bit too far there.
What's
it's
the
a,
point?
Like suicide. You don't joke about suicide. Somebody lost their life. You don't
if
joke
you
about it
the right way. You goddamn right. You
somebody,
joke about
somebody
it.
Dying.
A
you
good
don't,
comedian, which I'm not,
and everything else.
But
I
try
I
to be.
Know,
you
man.
Joke up. You take the most fucked up shit and try and make it funny.
I mean, I get it. I'm not a real sensitive person, and I can.
Here you go. Read John Morgan's comment.
It's a little offensive, Boone, but it's still a joke. As someone who was in the service, I'm not offended by it.
Thank
but
you, John.
There are other people that are going to
That's
be,
a sensible...
It's not something that... Suicide and Purple Hearts and things like
yeah,
that
I
are
I
not something...
I don't know why suicide. I didn't joke about suicide.
Well, a Purple Heart is somebody that's
joke.
Losing
that's
a leg or a limb.
Joke.
I don't agree with it, but we'll agree to disagree. Okay. Caller, you're live on WZR-TV. What's up?
What's going on, guys?
How you doing?
First of all, I got a few questions. Number one, you know... Am I crazy to think that Survivor Series is one of the top four pay-per-views?
I can barely hear you,
man.
Can you speak up just a little bit for me?
Am I crazy to think that Brock Lesnar being at one of the top four pay-per-views could happen, like Survivor Series?
Yeah.
Thanks for the call, man.
You know, Brock Lesnar, I mean, why is Brock Lesnar, who is the current WWE World Heavyweight Champion, why is he not on...
I should get a Purple Heart, this chair is squeaking so
Why is he not on one of the top four pay-per-views like Survivor Series? Your current WWE World Heavyweight Champion...
First of all, we don't know he's not going to be on Survivor Series. He's not supposed to be,
right.
And it's expected that he won't be.
Right.
Why is he not? Right here.
Tom,
money.
Yeah, it's about the money, man, and the contract that he's got. Tom Nelson, Daniel Bryan update. The latest on Daniel Bryan is that it looks like, I mean, listen, they've been trying to postpone this as long as possible to see...
Sports Entertainment Scoops had an update.
If there was
That's
any...
That's a good one.
You want a Purple Heart for that one?
No, I didn't get injured doing it.
But he's asking.
You just offended me with that joke, by the way.
Did I?
Calm down.
Wait a minute. Certain
things you don't joke about.
Can we not agree to disagree?
There's certain things you don't joke about. You just made a joke about Purple Hearts. A guy got his leg shut off for that. Okay?
Can we not agree to this?
You just did the same thing I did. It's okay when you do it. You just made a Purple Heart joke.
It's not, but you're going to continue on and on.
I'm not.
You just made it. Just a second ago, you made a second joke and a follow-up when we were completely done going over that. You followed it up. So I figured, all right, I'll chime in. I disagree.
Oh, my God.
I would not. I would not put something like that
up. I don't know if I can finish the show, man.
All right, let's drop it. Okay. Can we drop it?
Yes.
All right.
Daniel Bryan update, the surgeon.
Daniel Bryan, listen, it looks like he is
going
to need a second neck surgery coming here in the coming months.
Yeah.
He is not getting better. They're still tingling.
He's not getting the strength back.
Yeah. Right, right. So it looks like, you know, he's probably going to need Tommy John surgery, which is going to put him out probably close to a year, and
which,
he's already been out.
What really sucks is, if he would have, it was, I think it was in August, he could have got the second surgery then.
He already had it.
And he waited because they were telling him, no, you might be able to rehab and be better. And now it turns out, if he would have did it then, he'd be halfway through his recovery
right
now. Yeah.
Caller, you're live on WZR TV. What's up?
Matt Boone, you no good piece of shit. How dare you? I'm not thankful heart.
You're cutting out, but I can tell you're mad about the Purple Heart joke. Go ahead. Let it out, man.
I'm not really mad.
That was good.
You're the man, bro. All right, anything else?
He's still on. I don't look at a real question or not.
No, no, I just had to get that off.
All right. Well, that was funny. Thank you very much for the call, buddy.
Dan.
That's a funny joke.
Dan Langren. Daniel Bryan to miss the Rumble. Will he be at WrestleMania against who? I got to tell you, if he needs Tommy John surgery, he's not
going to be. We've heard he's not going to be Rumble ready. Right. Mania is a different story, but
if he has to undergo that second neck surgery, it's not going to happen, man.
Anthony Remy says, I face you on the WZR TV Fantasy Football League. Ryan, good luck. I guess you played
coming up this weekend. Good luck, Anthony.
He also says, Team 3D to the WWE? Question mark. You should talk about the Bully Ray teaser.
I think they're going to work New Japan Pro Wrestling. And it's interesting that Wrestle1 and TNA were co-promoting Bound for Glory. Now, over in Japan, Wrestle1 and New Japan Pro Wrestling are like the WWE and TNA of the United States, where they are in direct competition.
It's more like WWE and Pro Wrestling Guerrilla or something.
Right.
WWE is not as big as other.
Not nearly as big. But it would be, well, TNA's not nearly as big as WWE.
Yeah, but they're the second biggest in North America. WWE's not the second biggest Japanese promotion. Pro Wrestling Noah, there's a bunch of other bigger ones.
Yeah,
I think
Japan
doesn't exist anymore, but there's other bigger ones than.
But, so anyways, it's basically they're in direct competition with each other, and Team 3D goes out there pretty much on their final night within the company. I mean, Bully Ray, or Devon's contract expires in another month or two, but Impact is already taped ahead of time. So this is their final night within the company at Bound for Glory. So they kind of went out there, and I think we're going to find out more about this, but my guess is that it was the shoot promo where they don't care. We're done with TNA after tonight.
You're not explaining it like
and
that.
They tried
I'm a fan
to,
that didn't watch
they
it.
Went
no
out,
idea what you're talking
they
about.
Went out and called out the Bullet Club
when?
From New Japan Pro Wrestling at Bound for Glory,
yeah,
like
Bound
the guy's
Glory.
Talking about.
No, he didn't say
that. So at the pay-per-view, they go out and they call out the Bullet Club, which is a tag team, Jeff Jarrett and others, in New Japan Pro Wrestling.
Jeff Jarrett?
Yes.
Is in the Bullet Club.
Jeff Jarrett. Recently, within the last month or two, Jeff Jarrett has been involved with the Bullet Club
and
in
they
New
are
Japan
who?
Pro Wrestling. I don't
like
remember exactly. Yes, they're a group in
No,
New
I'm
Japan
not fucking with
I know.
Them. Seriously,
they're a group within New Japan Pro Wrestling. So Team 3D went out and called them out at the Bound for Glory pay per view.
They were inducted into the Hall of Fame.
That segment was edited off the Bound for Glory pay per view, so it didn't air.
So it was for the Japanese audience.
It
was
for the Japanese audience.
Not America.
You're basically on a Wrestle1 show, a TNA Wrestle1 show. So the fact that they called out a New Japan
would be like,
wrestling faction
it'd
is...
It'd be like the Usos calling out like Team 3D and TNA. Like, why the hell are they on WWE talking about... Yeah.
So that was edited out, which leads me to believe that Team 3D probably went and did a shoot promo on the pay-per-view, knowing that we're leaving TNA and we're not with Wrestle1.
To tie it in, on Twitter, Bully Ray has been teasing that him and Devon are going to go after another set of titles.
Their second favorite
set
of tag titles, which leads
me
to believe yeah. that they're going to go to New Japan Pro Wrestling. So the guy's asking here, Anthony Remy, I think they're going to do Japan. You think?
I agree, Japan. But I don't think they're going to go. I do think, and I hate to say it, forget D-Von.
Okay.
I could give a shit about D-Von. He's Bully Ray's backup. Bully Ray is a drummer for Bully D's band.
I think I know where you're going. Bully Ray is a huge loss for TNA. Bully Ray. No,
I'm
going to
say he'd be a huge gain for WWE.
Absolutely.
I think he, with this new Bully Ray character.
Best heel in pro wrestling?
Up there.
Probably.
Definitely up there.
I agree.
And I would say if WWE didn't do that, you were in TNA, we're going to punish you bullshit with him and let him be Bully Ray.
Let him
Bully Ray
come
is.
In. Yes.
Which they let the Dudley Boys be the Dudley Boys when they came from ECW.
They did.
But they let Taz do it too.
Look what happened to Christian when he came over from, you know what I mean?
And he was a WWE guy that went and came back. And
he was a top TNA guy and then he comes back.
Point being, if Bully Ray by himself came into WWE and they let him be Bully Ray and used him as a top guy, he'd be the top heel within 3 months.
Absolutely.
Because they're as short as shit in WWE on the heel side. They got a lot of faces.
Huh?
Heels, they're lacking, which makes me shocked that they're going to turn Orton babyface.
I know. I was just going to bring that up, too.
What the fuck else
do
they have? But, okay, Bully Ray is a heel in WWE?
Yeah.
To the moon, bro.
If they let him be.
If they don't punish him for being a TNA. For trying to make a living when they really, you know.
Matty Johnson is up next.
It's on you, man.
All right, we got, who do you think Bray Wyatt feuds with next? I think it'll be Ziggler.
Question.
Very good Raw last night, and Bound for Glory was mediocre.
Mediocre.
In my opinion.
I don't think it'll be Ziggler,
Bray Wyatt?
Fuck, man, I don't know.
Is it going to be...
If he's a babyface...
Is it going to be Harper or Rowan, or is he going to set them free and they're going to be... It's going to be a mutual split.
It's really hard to say... Right now,
with
because
vignettes.
We're just starting this stuff up.
I
but
know.
It seems like, and from what I'm reading and hearing, Bray babyface, Harper heel, Rowan, who the fuck knows.
Right.
But okay, so the logical thing would be Bray Harper.
Can I just, real quick, I think Harper becomes something. I think Rowan gets lost in the shuffle.
I wrote a column about that. I said if they're the Shield,
right.
Bray's Roman Reigns because WWE's behind him.
Absolutely.
Luke Harper is Dean Ambrose because Harper's got talent and he can get over whether they really, really push him or not. Not as much as
and you
not even as close as
you
much
can't,
as Ambrose.
I get what you're saying. Rowan
but
and Rollins are kind of the third wheel.
They're the guys
three.
That if...
But,
yeah. They're the guys that if WWE doesn't put the rocket on their back...
Yeah.
They don't have enough talent on their own, which Rollins turned out to have. I was completely wrong on that. And I always liked Rollins. I just thought WWE would bury him or just not do anything with him.
Right.
Kind of like Ziggler, kind of like Zack Ryder, kind of like, who was the guy we were talking about earlier? Damian Sandow.
Kind of like that,
like where he's so fucking good, but WWE just either doesn't realize it or doesn't care, and they don't do shit with him.
Right.
So,
right.
We'll see.
Hooray! Hooray!
Jorge Romero! What are your thoughts?
He's great on Twitter, by the way, isn't he?
He's awesome. He's great on Twitter. He is so fucking good. He's as good as Damian Sandow is his character.
Gives a lot of news to us on Twitter, man.
George Romero, Jorge Romero on Twitter. You will not be regretting it. What's your thoughts, he says, about TNA and Wrestle1's Bound for Glory pay-per-view and issues between the companies?
You know what it was? Wrestle1, basically, they were in charge of the Bound for Glory pay-per-view. The Wrestle1 promoter comes out and says, we're not going to have knockouts on the show because nobody cares about women's wrestling.
Yeah, it's kind of sexist.
Right? TNA eventually wound up stepping in and basically saying, wait a minute, this is our show.
Yeah.
It's our pay-per-view. I understand we're in your country and we're using...
And we're co-promoting,
your building, if you will. Not their building, obviously, but you know what I'm talking
about.
Where Wrestle1 is more known than TNA as far as Japanese promotions over there.
Yes.
But TNA wound up, controlling
their
own
pay-per-view. They did what they wanted. Yeah, in the end, they got what they wanted.
Right.
Kind of. He also says for the next month, the pregnant belly.
That's John Morgan, but.
Oh, shit, I'm sorry, that's you then, go ahead.
John Morgan, for the next month, the pregnant belly in Bray's videos will say it's coming. Then, on Monday, October 27th, the belly will say it's here. Time to renew your network subscription for just $9.99. And then we'll all flip over our TVs and stop watching WWE. I've said that I'm going to stop watching WWE. I can't, obviously.
I'm not allowed.
But
yeah,
listen,
do it.
A lot of people have tuned out.
I should get a Purple Heart.
A lot of people. Oh, well, a lot of people have tuned out. I remember the days where ratings were at 6.0s, 7.0s, and now we're at 2.
And that was only one half. WCW would do two or three.
Yeah, man.
While WWE, when they finally took them over in the ratings,
times have changed, dude.
To a two or a three, you're talking about 9 or 10 total.
Right, right.
We're lucky to get a three these days.
I know.
Total.
I know. Well,
Velasquez says, Matt, have you considered your own MMA show? I've been asked this a lot lately. Have you considered your own MMA show? Plus, MMA-related editorials would be a nice change from some of the recent ones, which are usually negative, in my opinion. Good show. Thanks for answering the question. I'll give you this. When you write editorials, it's about what evokes passion and what makes you really want to, when you have an idea and you want to just write. Considering the way wrestling is these days, 9 times out of 10, something that's really going to spark passion is something that sucks. Because there isn't something that's so good, you're like, God, I can't wait to write about how good this is. Name something that's that good.
Yeah.
And when it happens, few and far between, I do write about it. But for the most part, it's easier when you're thinking of, what should I write about today? What's big topical stuff? It's usually something that's the shits.
Right.
I did write an MMA one recently about Jim Ross's Battleground play-by-play. But, yeah, no, MMA show, there's not enough time in the day, man. I'm sorry.
I'm going to go a little bit overtime tonight for you guys tonight as we finish up these rapid-fire questions. David Hadley, what is the difference between... We've talked about this before. What is the difference between a no-holds-barred match, extreme rules match, and a street fight? There is no real difference, right?
Not
anything
really.
Goes. Weapons, yeah. You can use whatever. It's no-holds-barred.
You can throw no DQ in there. You can throw a false count anywhere in there.
No difference.
Really, nothing. Ryan Shoptaw says, do you think that TNA will go out and attempt to hire a huge name wrestler? And he gives Del Rio and Punk as examples in order to make other networks who are hesitant to offer a TV deal to them and maybe add interest from other networks as well.
They're trying.
It's kind of too late to do that. I mean, if they're going to get a new TV deal, they've either already got it or they're already in.
Got to be in talks, right?
Yeah. It's not like, all right, let's sign this guy and then start asking guys.
Right.
They're already talking. So.
They've only got a couple months before the end of 2014.
It's getting close, man.
Michael Benitez, which NXT star or stars do you see debuting on Raw the night after WrestleMania 31? I think the Ascension's
They'll
coming
be there before.
Sooner than WrestleMania 31. Yeah. I mean, you're talking 7 months from now?
Listen,
8 months?
If you're talking that far away.
You're talking November, December, January, February, March. You're talking
half
6 months
year,
away.
Yeah. Adrian Neville, Kevin Steen,
mm-hmm.
Fergal, Prince Devitt.
Prince Devitt.
Hideo Itami.
Right.
Fucking, God, there's so many, man.
There's a lot of guys that
NXT has a better roster.
It really does.
Than WWE, if you're a hardcore fan. Now, the mainstream casual fan would be like, who the fuck is that? Who the fuck is that? Who the fuck is that?
Right.
But if you appreciate wrestling,
if you guys,
and you watch an NXT show with the names we just listed,
absolutely.
Your mind will be blown.
If
You'll
you
be
guys,
like, God, this is what I've been missing every week.
If you guys watch NXT on Thursday nights on a network, bro.
And December 11th, we didn't mention this. December 11th.
Birthday.
Is that your sister's birthday? December 11th is the next NXT Live special on the WWE Network.
They announced that today, right?
And they announced a list of names that included Sami Zayn, who we just forgot to mention.
Elton Erica.
Yeah, same guys. Sami Zayn, Kevin Steen, Fergal Devitt, Hideo Itami, Adrian Neville, mm-hmm. all announced for that special. Now, did you just hear the amount of names I just listed off? That's going to be a badass
awesome.
Show.
And every NXT special have been great.
Off the charts.
All the takeover
old school
specials,
ECW.
Absolutely.
It's what a real epic. Wrestling fan would want to see.
If you haven't checked out NXT yet, I'm
you're
telling
missing
you,
out.
Check it out, especially the live specials.
Big time.
What do we got next from Mike Engler? Why did the Bills lose? You know what? We had sloppy offense this week, man. Our defense was great. We made some stupid mistakes, like giving up a field goal right before the half, two field goals right before the half. Just really, really stupid mistakes that we can't make if we're going to win games.
Paul Velasquez says, predictions. Anderson Silva versus Nick Diaz. Junior Dos, or we'll just go one at a time. Anderson Silva versus Nick Diaz.
You know what? You
don't
say are gonna call
stop.
Me
stop.
I'm a mark. I'm a
stop.
Mark. I'm a mark.
Yeah.
For Nick Diaz.
So
and
am
I know.
So
I
am
know
I.
That Nick is gonna go out there and he's gonna go right after the leg. He's gonna start taking the shit out of Anderson's leg, dude. Just to fuck
boxer.
With him. Just to fuck with him. I know, but he knows that Silva's coming back from that snap leg and a half, dude. Yo. You're gonna. I know it sounds stupid.
It
really does.
Does
because everybody. Anderson Silva is probably the best pound-for-pound fighter in the world.
John Jones.
You can't. Yeah. Right, John Jones. But you can't bet against Anderson Silva. I'm saying Diaz. I'm going to... You call me crazy. I know. And I'm thinking I'm stupid for saying it. But I'll do it. I'll do it. Somebody's got to take...
You do remember Diaz.
Somebody's got to take Nick quick. Diaz, and I'll do it.
You do remember Diaz is a welterweight, 170.
I'll be the guy to do it.
That's fighting Anderson Silva, a middleweight, 185, that has fought and won many times at 205. Somebody, Diaz is moving up to 85 to fight Silva.
Somebody has got to be the guy to pick Nick Diaz in case of an upset.
Yeah.
I'll be the dude to
now
do
listen,
it.
And listen,
I'll be the
and
guy.
There's
to
always
do it.
That thing, like when a guy gets knocked out for the first time, which Anderson Silva did in his two fights ago against Weidman.
Right.
It's even worse when you come back from something like that freak leg thing that he had.
Right.
And this is his first fight back from A, getting knocked out in the second fight ago.
Hey, he hasn't been
B,
back in a while.
Getting back in his other fight, getting the leg thing. He's going to be gun shy, or he could be gun shy. Diaz is a very technical boxer, but if you stand up with Silva, you lose.
So, I'll be the dude to take Nick Diaz.
I'll take Silva. Junior Dos Santos versus Stipe Miocic.
JDS.
I'm going to take Dos Santos.
Okay.
And do you see Brock Lesnar returning to the UFC?
Somebody recently said...
To the UFC after his deal was up after Mania. It was Mike Goldberg.
Okay.
UFC
Mike
commentator.
Goldberg.
Talk about Mike Goldberg. We talked about it before the break. We said that he was going to do the Vikings Bills.
Speaking of the Bills, the... This guy just asked Mike.
I was going to throw it in, and then I remembered in my head, oh, we already talked about it. Yeah, he was supposed to... He did the Minnesota Vikings versus Detroit Lions game.
Atrocious.
This past Sunday, and he was screwing up names, screwed up the name of the arena, a bunch of different things. On Twitter, he was getting blasted.
Yeah,
he fired back. He told one fan to fuck off.
He called another fan a douche. Right,
and because of that, which he ended up deleting those tweets, but he posted them before he did.
Yeah.
And it ended up blowing up. That story I put up was enormous. But Fox issued a statement today announcing that he's not doing the Vikings Bills. He's supposed to do two
games.
He's supposed to do two games. Because UFC has to deal with Fox, so Goldberg's technically a somewhat of a Fox employee. So they said, all right, he's a good announcer. We need somebody to do these two games in Minnesota for Fox.
Right.
Let's use him.
Right.
First one in, he sucked. Everybody said he sucked. And then on top of him sucking, he was cussing out fans in public on social media. So they said, you're not doing the next game. You're out.
There's about 20 more rapid-fire questions. So can we do
Let's
one
do them
more
fast.
Answers?
Come on, boom, boom,
because I got to get out of here tonight, man.
All right, David Hadley says, news with Dana Bryan's return. We've already talked about it.
Andy Siegel, what's the story with WWE doing Raw from Madison Square Garden? Is it still too expensive? I see they do house shows there. Yeah, they're just not running the arena.
The building rent is... It's not cost effective.
Sky high, they raised it, and they're not doing events as often as they used to.
Vincent Nugent says, to follow up on Anthony's question, will Team 3D, Bully Ray and Devon, opt to go to New Japan and possibly face the likes of the Bullet Club if WWE's not in?
Talked about that earlier. John Morgan, what would you guys do to help motivate people to sign up for the network? Personally, I'd be trying methods like if you sign up for a six-month contract, you're automatically entered to win two free tickets to a WWE event in your area. What do you think? I agree with that. You've got to do promotional
stunts is only going to do so much. I think content is the way. They need more
original
content.
That
WWE Countdown,
original
WrestleMania
content.
Rewind, the Monday Night War, Legends House, more shit like that. Problem is, and I know there's more than one it takes too much production money and this and that to make these kind of shows, and they can't invest that kind of money when
they're not making it.
Exactly.
So a more original content and promotional offers like
yes. AJ Clark says, who is better, Brian Pillman or Dean Ambrose? Do you believe Ambrose's character is a Brian Pillman ripoff? He's Ryan Clark's biggest fan.
I wasn't
fan in the chat
big
room.
On Brian Pillman back in the day. You were more.
Flying Brian Pillman, I loved as a kid. The loose cannon Brian Pillman, you didn't like that guy?
I don't.
He was awesome.
Back in the day, bro.
I respect you, Booker, man, and all that shit.
But Dean Ambrose against Brian Pillman?
The loose cannon Pillman? That's a
too
tough one.
Is
man.
It too early for Ambrose? We
it's too early to say Ambrose has more promise. He's going to be a bigger deal than Pillman ever would have been, even if he didn't.
Matt Johnson, what do you think of Dixie Carter making a mockery of the life-threatening storm in Japan as a way to promote Bound for Glory?
Typhoon,
a show many didn't even watch. People trashed her on Twitter, and she deserved it for those comments.
She ended up apologizing.
Big typhoon that hit Tokyo, Japan. I believe it hit today or tomorrow.
It's supposed to.
It's supposed to hit. It was, as of yesterday, it was on a direct course to hit Tokyo. I don't know if it hit today or tomorrow, but
it hit Japan, but it was
not a good thing.
For Tokyo, they were worried about Bound
I guess
for Glory.
If Boone can joke about Purple Hearts, Dixie can joke about typhoons.
Yeah, she's the president of a giant company. I'm not.
That's true.
Stephen Williams Jr. or Steve Williams Jr. says, Matt Boone, not you need to grow a beard like Bryan Danielson.
Oh, grow a big old beard. Now you need.
Oh, now you need to grow a big beard like Daniel Bryan. Okay, I'll do it.
David Happy again. Why is WWE planning matches like Triple H versus The Rock and Sting versus Hulk Hogan for WrestleMania 21 instead of planning matches for Triple H, Rock, and Sting against current stars? I agree with that. Well, I brought it up on
Facebook.
Like
Dean Ambrose, Roman Reigns, and Bray Wyatt.
I think you need to use veteran guys like Rock, Austin, Hogan, people like that. If you're going to have them wrestle against rookie stars, up-and-comers, so that you can get the rub. They can get the rub.
Yes, I agree for the most part, except you need one, at least one, take your pick, Sting, Taker, whoever,
big
one dream match that you'll never see, never thought you'd see, at least give that to the people. And then, the others, big names, use them to elevate
put the younger
guys.
Stars over. Correct. Elevate the new guys. Right. Vincent Nugent.
Matt, do you really have issues with Facebook user John Harris and the way
I blocked him a long time ago.
And the way he acts when he comments on certain Facebook threads in your timeline, or are you just playing around with that guy? No, I was not playing around. I don't like him.
I think I blocked him a long time ago. David Hadley, why are Cena and Ambrose in a street fight against the Authority next week instead of a tag team title match after beating the Usos and the Dust? Who knows? It's WWE logic.
And I'm starting to regret what I just said about John here. I don't hate him. There's something about him that runs me the wrong way. Vincent Nugent says, did you guys watch last week's edition of TNA Impact Wrestling? If so, what were your thoughts on that epic three-way tag team Full Metal Mayhem match for the TNA World Tag Team Championships between the Wolves, the Hardy Boys, and Team
That was
Team.
Awesome. I know you didn't see it, but I watched it.
I heard
it
about
was
it.
Awesome. Yeah. Spot after spot after spot. Just a sick match. If you guys haven't checked it out, I'm sure it's on YouTube. Check it out. Google it. Or YouTube it. Yeah. It's up there. Vincent Nugent, again. What do you guys think about Bret Hart finally made peace with Earl Hebner recently at a big time wrestling event?
Yes.
You know what? Bret has said in recent years that his issues weren't
really with Earl Hebner. Yeah, yeah.
His issues were more with Vince McMahon
and Sean. Anybody, yeah.
But Hebner was just out there doing what he was told, and he wanted to keep his job. So the issues were never really between Bret and Earl. So
never.
But
yeah,
they
no.
buried that.
The fans in Canada, you screwed Bret anytime Earl's anywhere. But yeah. Right. Christopher Brown says, once all the anti-Russian sentiment is done, what can you see them doing with Lana and Rusev long term?
I don't think they continue the Russian gimmick for a while.
That's pretty much the gimmick, man.
And that's it.
Unless they do a complete overhaul gimmick change like down the road, that's who he is for a while, you know?
Vincent Nugent again, did you guys watch last week's edition of the 15th anniversary WWE SmackDown show? If so, your thoughts?
I didn't see SmackDown. I watched the Rock and Triple H segment backstage.
I did see that on YouTube.
Was really cool, yeah.
It was about a 6-minute segment.
Six and a half minutes, really good.
David Hadley.
He says, what do you think are the possibilities of a network actually buying TNA? If they do indeed get picked up by WGN, could you see CM Punk actually signing with them then, since WGN is Chicago-based?
It is Chicago-based, but that doesn't have anything to do with it. Yeah, I mean, it's kind of a good thing.
Chances of a network buying TNA, if it was going to happen, Spike would have bought them, and it didn't. I think
at this point, if the price is right,
put it this way,
TNA would be...
Yeah, if it's between going out of business or being a shit company or letting somebody else buy ownership.
Yeah, yeah.
Because Spike wanted to, and Dixie didn't want to sell majority interest.
Right, right.
Spike, even though it would have been the best thing she's ever done, but whatever.
Vince Nugent, what's next for the now former WWE ring announcer Justin Roberts post WWE? Now listen, man, he just got released last night. We're less than 24 hours.
What does a ring announcer do? An hour and a half.
I mean, TNA just signed Josh Matthews. Could they sign Justin Roberts, or is Josh Matthews enough? Does he go to TNA? I'm sure that
what
you're
does it pay
Justin.
If he goes to TNA? What's the future if TNA doesn't exist?
I think Justin's probably going to wind up in the indie scene. He's probably going to have to go and find a full-time job.
I think out of wrestling. Maybe radio, because he's got a voice.
Maybe radio, something like that. But I think in his spare time, he will do part-time announcing work for indie promotions.
All right, finishing up is Mr. Lance Winter, one of my favorites.
Congrats on the big win, man.
Yes.
Fantasy football.
He says, the Damian Sandow thing, why he's in the doghouse, I think it's because he's great friends with Poffo family. I don't know, maybe.
Lanny Poffo,
Randy Savage, yeah, I don't know.
So that's it, man. That's rapid fire. We got through them all.
Is he really friends with him, or is he saying...
I don't know.
I think his Damian Sandow character is considered by many to be a ripoff of The Genius, which was Lanny Poffo's character.
Okay.
I don't know if that was a joke or what that was, but
hey.
Yeah.
So that's it, brother.
That's Tuesday.
We got through all the rapid fire segments. We got through all the phone calls. Yes. We got through everything.
Raw.
We started on time tonight. Yes, we did. We were here right on time.
Real quick before we head out, yes, MMA things. It's rumored that Dana White and Lorenzo Fertitta, the UFC co-owner and UFC president, met with George St. Pierre in Montreal today about a return.
Really?
Vannelly Silva made a post saying he pretty much teased that he's coming out of retirement to fight for somebody not
already, huh?
To fight outside of the UFC.
Okay.
A lot of people think one FC in Asia because he's banned for life in Nevada, so he can't fight in America.
Right.
But he's on a contract with UFC. I don't think he even realizes they're not going to just let him go fight somewhere else.
Right.
Kind of like when Couture wanted to fight Fedor, but he still had one fight left in his UFC deal.
Right.
They went to court, and then eventually he had to come back and fight Brock Lesnar, get knocked out.
Yeah.
Right. And I'm trying to think. There's a bunch of big MMA news. Whatever. Those go to efightnews.com if you want MMA coverage. There's a lot of great shit there. We'll even plug MMAnews.com for the Jake Shields interview last week one more time. So, yeah, check it out. A lot of MMA shit going on.
All right. That will do it.
That'll do it.
Another Tuesday night.
A little dabble, do you?
We will see you guys.
Yes. Not class. God ass.
What's he saying? What's time?
Not class. Oh, wait. Yeah.
I got... Not class, got
ass. No, ass, not class.
Ass.
Something.
Ass, not class. Get the fuck out of here. Get the fuck out of here.
Get out of here. All right,
we will see you guys next Tuesday night. What are you coming back with next week? What's your gimmick next week?
I'm going to do the Fu Manchu, the Hulk Hogan.
Fu Manchu.
Yes.
Is that what they call it?
Stay tuned, yes.
The Fu Manchu.
Yeah. Oh, wait. Yeah, I think it's Fu Manchu.
All right, we're out of here. We will see you guys next Tuesday night, 8-10 Eastern Time, WZRonline.com. We want your feedback.
Yes, we
Tell
do.
Them, Matt Boone, how they can submit some feedback.
Pretty simple. You go to Facebook.com, you type a slash, then you type Ryan Clark, WZR, if you want to give him feedback. You go to Facebook.com/... Porn must. I mean, Ryan Clark WZR. Facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR. Give him feedback. Facebook.com/ Ryan Clark WZR.
When you said Ryan Clark WZR the first time, and then you said Ryan Clark WZR the second time, now you're going to do Matt Boone.
It was a prolonged thing. I know what I'm doing.
But you know,
step aside, kid. Facebook.com/ Matt Boone WZR. Facebook.com/ Matt Boone WZR. Give me your feedback there. Brian Clark's feedback there. We'll, we want your feedback. Get us out of here.
We want your feedback. We'll see you guys next Tuesday night, 8-10 Eastern Time, WZRonline.com. Four! Matt Boone.
Me.
Brian Clark.
Him.
See you next Tuesday night, 8-10 Eastern Time.
Mm-hmm.
Started from the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're here.
Strilla. I'm away.